Committee to order. Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
This meeting is being livestreamed by Chelmsford Telemedia and posted to the Chelmsford Public Schools website for interested community members to access and watch. In-person public participation will be taking place tonight in accordance with the Chelmsford School Committee Public Participation Guidelines. Anyone speaking tonight during the public input portion of the meeting has notified the superintendent's office of their desire to speak and has been provided with these guidelines. Upon request, written comments received no later than 12 p.m. on the day of this meeting will also be read and made a part of the record of the meeting during the second public comment session. Are there any members of the press attending tonight? No. Okay. Welcome to our school committee meeting. Our first order of business is to approve the minutes from our meetings, and there's a lot of them, on February 28th and March 7th. I'll take them separately.
Separately?
Yes.
I move that the committee approve the minutes for the regular scheduled meeting on February 28th, 2023.
Second.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
5-0. All right.
I move that the school committee approve the regular school committee meeting minutes of March 7th, 2023.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, and then we're going to move into the approval of the executive session minutes. So I'll take a motion for each of those as well.
Each of them.
I believe, I think I have to do each of them, yes.
Each of them, right?
Each one of them, yes.
I should have napped today. I move that the school committee approve the minutes of the regular, no, I'm back to number three, sorry. I move that the school committee approve the minutes of the executive session school committee meeting on May 4th, 2021.
Second.
Any questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
I move that the school committee approve the minutes of the executive session school committee meeting on July 20th, 2021.
Second.
Questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
5-0.
I move that the school committee approve the minutes of the executive session school committee meeting on March 7th, 2022.
Second.
Any questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
5-0.
I move that the school committee approve the minutes of the executive session school committee meeting on August 16th, 2022.
Second.
Any questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
I move that the school committee approve the minutes of the executive session school committee meeting on November 15th, 2022.
Second.
Any questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
5-0. You're abstaining?
Yep.
Okay.
I wasn't there.
Oh, I apologize. Dennis, I did not realize that you weren't there. So that would be 4 yes, 1 abstain.
I move that the school committee approve the minutes of the executive session school committee meeting on December 6th, 2022.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
I move that.
Hold on. Are you an aye?
I said aye, yeah.
Oh, I didn't hear.
I usually do the hand.
I saw it. I was looking for the hand, yeah.
It was lazy of me. I'll continue with my motion when I vote.
I just want to make sure you were there.
No, I'm an aye.
All right, 5-0.
There goes my momentum. I move that the school committee approve the minutes of the executive session school committee meeting on December 12th, 2022.
Second.
Any questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
5-0.
I move that the school committee approve the minutes of the executive session school committee meeting on December 20th, 2022.
Second.
Any questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
I move that the school committee approve the minutes of the executive session school committee meeting on January 3rd, 2023.
Second.
Questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
5-0.
I move that the school committee approve the minutes of the executive session school committee meeting on January 9th, 2023.
Second.
Questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
5-0.
I move that the school committee approve the minutes of the executive session school committee meeting on February 7th, 2023.
Second.
Questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
5-0. Well done, Jeff.
Thank you very much.
Pressure.
I was lulled into a sense of complacency there. So.
That was the whole point.
All right. Next up, we have our Chelmsford High School student representatives.
Hello, everyone. Spring sports have all now officially started, and for the third year, Student Council will be hosting the Leadership Conference on Half-Day Tuesday, April 4th. There will be panels with many distinguished speakers speaking on college, business, arts, STEM, leadership, and financial literacy. There will also be a complimentary breakfast for those who attend.
Winter sports awards are tonight at the gym at CHS, and the class of 2024 election was held, and the results are in. With Rohan Madhukumara as president, Sherry Guo as vice president, Nolan Busalaki as secretary, and Nina Fredericks as treasurer. Congrats to these outstanding students. House Olympics, a school-wide competition between the three houses, Emerson, Hawthorne, and Whittier, is now over. And in first place is Emerson, followed by Whittier in second and Hawthorne in third.
How could the day get any better?
The Emerson tradition continues. What can I say?
All right. Excuse me, I've got to go back to the other one. Do we have any good news that we would like to share?
Good news is presenting this evening, so if anybody else has any good news, they can certainly do that at this time.
Hi, Jeff. This is for you. To say that someone has done something lifelong is an accomplishment. To say that someone has done something lifelong in the service of others is truly special. And that is you, someone who is truly special. You've been a lifelong educator, mentor, and advocate for the students and staff of the Chelmsford Public Schools. After you were retired, you were asked once again to return to serve the needs of the district. Your patience, your thoughtfulness, your compassion and wisdom helped guide us through some really difficult times, COVID in particular. And not many people understand this about this position, but it's volunteer. And the hours and the time and the energy that you had to put in during that time was extraordinary, and we will forever be grateful for that. I am really going to miss you, as I am sure the rest of the members of this committee will. You have served the district in so many ways that will not only be recognized, but will never be recognized, because that's just the kind of guy you are. So on behalf of the Chelmsford Public Schools, I'd like to present you with this gift and thank you for your service.
Thank you.
If I could too, I'd like to just apologize to Jeff. You know, 3.5 years ago, cornered him at a retirement party, and we knew Mr. Thomas was retiring from the school committee, and said, "You come on, it's easy. You know, a couple of meetings here and there." And then we even sucked him into a full 3-year term. Yeah. Said, "Piece of cake. You won't have to do much." And then COVID hit and everything else, and it was an uneasy thing. And as Donna said, you know, your presence on this committee has been well appreciated. Your calming influence and always thoughtful about what's going on, and you'll be really missed on the committee. So,
may I?
Of course.
So, Jeff, first of all, I'm going to miss my vest buddy because I don't think anybody else is going to really keep up with the Chelmsford vest friend. So I'll just keep that torch going for you.
Thank you.
Everything's about a legacy. So, honestly, I'll be brief, because if I've learned anything from Jeff, it's about brevity, like just kind of not just paying attention and speaking when it makes sense to speak. And sometimes when people do that, unlike me who talk, I just speak all the time. People are more willing to listen. And you're a kind person, and you got me through a lot of really difficult things. And it's funny you mentioned COVID, because COVID was really hard on all of us, and I had a really hard time with it. And I remember very many times Jeff calling me or texting me, telling it's going to be all right. We're just going to get through it. So that's a good friend, and I really appreciate you here. And like you said, you left a really good legacy, even if you can't beat Al Thomas in tennis yet. But
second to Al is just pretty good.
It's pretty good. I'll take it. So no,
second to Al.
But I love working with you, man. I love you. And you know, you're gonna enjoy retiring from this for sure. You'll miss me though.
I will.
Well, Jeff, I've got a cold and I wore the mask just to remind you that you served during COVID, okay? But I truly have enjoyed serving with you on this committee, Jeff. I've appreciated your openness to our many points of view. Your sincere devotion to the education of the students, and your true commitment and dedication to this community as a whole. Your service on the school committee, I think, really did endure COVID And you have helped so much with the everlasting impacts of COVID. I'll always remember you reminding us all that what one person does impacts all the others deeply in the community, and that we as a committee must keep the welfare of all in mind when making policy decisions. Your wisdom runs deep. Your caring and dedication to education runs deeper. And I hope you get to enjoy some well-deserved time with your lovely wife and family, but I'll miss serving with you truly. I look forward to seeing you at the CHS Theater with your daughter and enjoying together, okay? Thank you.
Briefly, Jeff, you know I appreciate everything you've done. I appreciate you being willing to serve in the school committee and bringing the perspective of a former staff member in the district, both teacher and administrator, and then, you know, I consider you a colleague. So very much appreciate you on behalf of the administration. We really enjoyed working with you. We know you're not going away, and we could always pull you in for something in the future if something comes up. But we very much appreciate it. So thank you.
Thank you.
Can I actually say,
of course,
this may be the longest I ever speak. I can't express to the people that I've worked with, you know, when I think when we got through COVID, I think of everyone in central administration, you know, when you think what Bill Silver's people did, Amy Reese, you know, with Brian Curley, that we were able to pull that off. You know, the liaison groups I worked with, CHIPS PTO, High School PTO, Alumni Association, the boosters, the one that I really enjoyed that everyone thought would be tough would be capital planning. And that was great because of John Souza and Paul Cohen. I mean, the relationship between the town and the school committee is so important, and they were so great. I just love walking into this building. Jane will meet you at the desk, Debbie and Robin in the office, Kathy. I mean, everyone was just so pleasant, so great to work with. I can't express enough the people in our schools, what they went through. I taught half a semester at National Community College on a Zoom, and I don't know how all of you did it through the whole process, but everyone from, you know, the custodial staff keeping the schools clean, you know, our professional support staff, our coordinators, our school administrators, parents, students, and especially the teachers that not only got us through a pandemic, but the beautiful job, the hard work they do every day. And a lot of it doesn't get seen. And I think having, you know, those of us who have done the job, it's, you know, it's hard to see. You don't stop when the bell rings. You drive to work thinking about what went right, and you drive home thinking about what went wrong. And I can't express how proud I am of all those involved. Joanna, I'll miss signing warrants. I really, I had one more time signing warrants, but the wonderful job you and, you know, the business department, it's incredible. Linda?
Yeah, good.
You know, it's like we've known each other through, we work together, we're colleagues together, and of everyone here, I think you're the only one who really gets my sense of humor, but your dedication, your leadership, it's huge that we're on the track that we're on through the hard times and the change. Education's different from when I retired, and I can't express enough how I feel about you. And Jay, years ago when we met, when you were Patrick and Bridget's tennis coach, and Kevin Branco and Andy Schubach aren't going to like this, but you are the best tennis coach they ever had.
Wow.
Well, really, when Jay started to teach at the high school, my wife Patty was very upset because he stopped coaching tennis, so Patrick and Bridget didn't have him as a coach anymore. But we are so fortunate, and I say it all the time, to have you as our superintendent. Your honesty, your financial knowledge, your compassion. We're in a good place, and we're in a good place because of your leadership and the leadership of the team, and you four. I'll be okay. I can't thank you enough. I can't thank you enough for your guidance, your support, especially your patience with me. I don't think this town realizes how fortunate they are to have four people who are so dedicated, passionate, intelligent, and caring, all right, that this school system and this town is better off because of the four of you. And before I finish that, my student reps, you guys are great, but back to you guys, I wouldn't have been able to do what I've done without you, and I can't express with everything you've done, your friendship, but how important, how humbled, and how honored I am to have been a part of this team. And you're not going to get rid of me that quickly. Love you all. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Jeff. Okay, I'm done. Bye.
And thank you very much. Very thoughtful. You didn't have to do anything, but thank you so much.
All right.
Oh, did, and my wife and kids, I'm sorry. Thank you. Patty, Patrick, and Bridget, thank you for your patience and your support.
Linda started playing music when you said that.
Yes. All right. All right. That is the longest I've spoken, except for motions the last 3 weeks.
That's all right. Thank you.
You guys.
It's the least we could do. So, do we have any public input tonight?
We don't.
All right. So moving on to new business.
Yeah. We're going to jump right in. We actually have a packed agenda tonight. We've got some very good presentations. I'm looking forward to hearing. We have a couple of our departments who are here this evening. The first up is Jessica Nolette with our languages and our exchange program department. So we welcome Jessica, and we're very interested to hear what's happening within the department. So I'll turn it over to you.
Great. Thank you for having me again. It's a pleasure to be here. I'm going to speak about two awesome things tonight. One is our Seal of Biliteracy initiative, and the second are our cultural exchange programs that happened this year. And I have three students behind me who are going to join and tell you a little bit about their experience hosting a Spanish or French student in the fall. And then we just came back from our trips over February break. So first I'll start with the Seal of Biliteracy. Just to refresh your memory, this is the fourth year we've been doing the Seal of Biliteracy. It's an initiative from the Department of Education to award seniors who are proficient in English and a world language. So they demonstrate their proficiency in English by their ELA MCAS scores, or if they're an L student, we can use their WIDA, their access test scores as well. And then they sign up in the fall with me to take a world language exam. Those were administered this February. And I just put together a little table for you of the number of students we've had testing and the number of awards. There are a couple different reasons for the numbers. In 2021 and 2022, because of the pandemic, DESE changed some of the requirements of what students needed to earn the seal. So the numbers were a little bit different. But I'm super proud that this year we had our the highest number of students testing ever. We had 40 seniors test. Some of them are still testing. But I have some great news to share with you on the next slide. So we have, these are the languages that students have tested in over the past 4 years. These are languages that they study in our school for Spanish, French, and this year we had 5 seniors who went through our ASL program test in American Sign Language, which is awesome. And then all the other languages you see there are home languages that students are learning on their own. They speak at home, they learn with families, and we should be really proud that we have that kind of language diversity here. And I definitely want to encourage our community to keep encouraging your students to use those languages at home, read in them, write in them, speak in them, because they're so important. And for a senior to be able to graduate with this kind of recognition is amazing. And being able to speak a second or third language is always something that will be valuable in your career or in your studies. So I really want to keep encouraging our seniors to take advantage of that. So this year, so far, because the numbers, the scores are still coming in, we have 3 seniors who have earned the Seal of Biliteracy with Distinction, which is the highest level of award that they can earn. It means they have a great MCAS score and they have an advanced low level of proficiency. So advanced is one of the highest ranges you can get. And we have 13 seniors, again, so far that have earned the Seal of Biliteracy, 15 awards total because several of those students have earned the Seal of Biliteracy in 2 languages, which is amazing. So that's something to be really proud of. In the next few weeks, as I get final scores, I'll definitely share that with the community and we'll announce the students for you. But they'll be recognized at the Senior Awards Ceremony in June. They receive a special seal that goes in their high school diploma, and they receive a certificate as well. So are there any questions about the seal before I move on with the exchanges? Okay. So we finally were able to fulfill our cultural exchange program this year. This is something we started 4 years ago, and because of COVID, it kept being postponed and postponed. So this fall, you might remember, we hosted a group of students from the San Estanislao de Cosca School, which is in Malaga, Spain. They're our partner school in Spain. And from a school in La Rochelle, France, called Fenelon Notre Dame. So we hosted the Spanish students in September and the French students in October. The picture you see there is a picture from our Spanish exchange. We were in a tiny village called Frigiliana, which gave us beautiful, picturesque views. So I was one of the chaperones on the Spanish exchange. It was a great experience. One of our students will tell you a little bit more in a second, but we definitely, one of the highlights was a cooking class that students did when we were traveling. They learned how to make paella and gazpacho all together, which was awesome. We have some great cooks in the group and some people who had not cooked a lot before, so that was a good experience. And it was really great to see students connect with each other on both exchanges, both when they hosted here and then by the end of the trip. Our CHS students were really close, even if they didn't know each other that well before. They had come from all different grade levels, different experiences. They became a really close-knit group, and the connections they built with their French and Spanish counterparts was really amazing to see in such a short time, because our Spanish students were here for about 10 days in September. The French students were here for even less. They were here for just a week, and by the end of the week, there were kids in tears saying goodbye to each other. They had built a really nice bond, so we'll hear from them more about their experience. So if you guys want to come up, pull up a chair. We want to hear from you. If you just scoot those up. So we're going to start with Leah. She was on our Spanish exchange. You can introduce yourself and just talk a little bit about your experience.
So I am Leah McGuigan, and I am a senior, and I actually signed up to participate in the trip as a freshman, and I was supposed to go as a sophomore, so I'm very glad I got to go 2 years later. And I wanted to host because I had never been to Europe before, but I love to travel. I think it's something that everybody should be doing, and so I immediately jumped at the chance to be able to host as well, which was a wonderful experience. My host sister became very close with me and my family, and we did a lot of really fun activities. We went to Salem and just other activities with my family and other activities around the school. They loved the football games. And then after one of the dances, all the students and their hosts went to one of the host house, and we made s'mores for the first time. They had never made s'mores before. And in Spain, we all loved our time. It is true, we became very, very close. We say hi in the hallways still, and we pretty much all of us still talk to our host families and the other people that we met at their school. And if there was anything that we wanted to do more of, it was spend more time at their school. And we met people from all different grade levels, and we really connected with them. And even though there were like some language barriers, we still were able to communicate and understand each other very well. So I'm very grateful for the opportunity.
Thank you.
And then these two students are from our French exchange program.
All right. You want me to stand up?
No.
I feel like it's the. The mic's also there, so. Yeah.
Thank you.
All right. So my name's Will Dorman. I went on the French exchange program, and I went to the trip to France, and I also hosted a French student at my humble abode in Chelmsford. So, I'll talk about the first week first. So that I hosted a French student for a week. Here was in October. So how it went is we didn't really have like a full schedule, wasn't as organized for them as when, well, they came here, they had their own activities. But for the most part, I did a lot of stuff with them. I got to know them very well. It's very similar to what Leah said about the Spanish program. You get to form, like, you get to form very good bonds with a lot of the people there. You get to know them very well. There was a lot of, you get to learn some of the interesting cultural aspects in the way of, They eat a copious amount of bread, and also France is solely responsible for keeping Nutella in business. But It was very interesting to kind of to talk to them and see how their culture was different from ours. And we had a lot of fun with our French exchange group. We kind of went as a group. We did different activities. We showed them Witch's Woods, a cool place in Chelmsford. What, Chelmsford?
Salem.
It's in Westford. But it was very cool. They all enjoyed it, and they thought a lot of the stuff here was interesting. But for the French trip, where we went as a group, it was a lot of fun. Really, I think retrospectively, I kind of waited to really give my opinion until I completed the trip. Just retrospectively, I didn't want to call anything too early. There were good days and bad days. The bad days were usually when I was in like French class, and they're talking about like some book they read, and I'm not understanding it at all because it's like a high school level French class in France. So it was a challenge, but there were a lot of things that were a lot of fun. We went to go to an aquarium. We toured La Rochelle, the city. So it was very interesting. They bike a lot. There's a lot of La Rochelle is not a very car centric city. Like say Chelmsford, if you want to walk from say the center of town to the high school, it's a bit difficult because there's a lot of intersections you got to go through. But in La Rochelle, it's a lot more designed for like bicycles and pedestrians. So every morning I was like, it's like 35 degrees out, and I have to, in the cold, I'm just like biking to school. And that was an experience, I'll say that. You can't get that anywhere else. So there was a lot of, we enjoyed the culture, the food, we got to see some of the landmarks, the Eiffel Tower, and whatnot. So it was a lot of fun, really.
Thank you.
Hello. My name's Nurse Aldea. I'm also a senior. I went on the French exchange trip. I signed up because Madame Chagnon told me about it in class. She was like advertising it to our class, and I was like, I had always thought it would be really cool to be an exchange student, but like, you know, most of the time you have to commit for like 3 months or something like that, and I was never sure that I wanted to do that. So when I saw this opportunity to host someone and then, you know, go for just a week, I thought it was great. Some part of me sometimes wishes it was for 3 months just because I miss them so much. But yeah, it was great. When we hosted them, I clicked with my correspondent like immediately, my host sister. My mom had to go pick her up because I had practiced that night. But, you know, when she got to my house, it was like immediate, like we were great friends. And then it was nice to have the weekend right after to hang out with them because I got to meet all of them. I had a group of 5 friends that were also in the doing the program with me. So I met all of their correspondents, and I met people I had never met before, like Will. I had never met Will before this, but, you know, now we have some good laughs together. And I just thought it was so amazing that we, throughout the week that they were here, we did just about everything together. Like, Saturday, we spent the whole day together. I went to brunch with one of my friends, our correspondent. We all went apple picking. We went and took that picture at our friend's house, and we were making s'mores because they had also never had s'mores. We took them to the football game. We went to Witch's Woods, and by that time, it was 10 p.m., and we had been together all day. Throughout the course of the week, we were all just inseparable. And like Miss Nolette said, by the time they had left, even though it was only a week, we were all in tears. Like, we were all so upset, but we're like, it's okay, we'll see you in February. So then when we went, it was like so surreal to see them again, because I remember we were sitting in like a picnic area at their school. We were playing a card game that Madame Gabois had brought. And one of them, like, he tried to sneak up on us. So he like hid behind a potted plant, and he like shushed the teachers. He's like, shh. And he snuck up behind us, and we were all like, oh my gosh, Thomas. So it was really surreal to see them again, and it was so awesome. Definitely, like, La Rochelle was so different from here, because when we were here, you know, a lot of us were upperclassmen, and like the culture's just so different. We all have like cars, so we would just pick each other up and go together all the time. And also, our school ends at 2 p.m. so we have all that time at the end of the day. But like over there, it was crazy because like they go from school to like 8 to 5 p.m. and it doesn't feel that long because they've got lots of breaks during the day. But like, we get home and we'd be like, oh my gosh, it's 5 p.m. So we like, just because we had all grown so close and like we hadn't seen, like it was more difficult to see like other French students that weren't our correspondents. We were like making time to hang out all the time, just all of us together. And I remember one time we all went bowling, and my friend and I commented on how we thought it was funny that they were herding us around, because she and I, we were herding them around when they were here. So we're like, oh my gosh, the tables really have turned. But it was an amazing experience. I've made lifelong friends because of it. You know, as we were leaving for the second time, there was, again, a lot of tears, and they're like, but, like, you're not, there's no, we'll see you in February, like, there's nothing else, and we're like, yeah, but, like, it's not like I'm never going to talk to you again. I mean, just today, I, like, posted on my Instagram one of those, like, little, like, caption things that was, like, post a hug, and I posted, like, the picture of us when we were hugging them when we were leaving, and I was like, oh, you know, I miss my French friends. So it was really great, because, like, it was advertised, like, you're going to make a lifelong friend with your correspondent, and now I have, like, 16 that I made from the trip, and it was just, it was really great. I'm, like Leah said, I'm so grateful for the opportunity to have been able to do this.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Does anyone have any questions for them?
I just, back when I was teaching, we did the British exchange. I'm so happy that the exchanges are back, because they're, the friendships you make, the cultural experience you have, it's irreplaceable. So, and I'm glad you guys were able to do it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. I just shared some extra photos that Madame Chagnon shared with us when they were in France. And then just to wrap up, we're going to continue to promote the Seal of Biliteracy for our seniors. We want to encourage them to sign up for that experience and keep practicing their language skills. We are going to begin enrolling for next year's Spanish and French exchanges this spring. I think the consensus from families was that we wanted this to happen every year, which is great. I'm happy to do that. And then just last week, in a separate note, we found out that our French 4 and Spanish 4 classes have been approved to be taken as dual enrollment classes with Middlesex Community College next year. So we are joining the DE programming, and we're really excited about that.
Great.
Okay. That's awesome.
So thank you for having me. I'm happy to answer any questions.
You've done a terrific job. You know, bringing things back online again. It was really, I remember several years ago someone had reached out to the school committee and asked what had happened with the exchange programs, and I think that was about the time that you were coming on board. So, you know, I appreciate all of the hard work that goes into the planning for these things, as well as the wonderful curriculum that you offer over at the middle school and high schools. Mm-hmm. So thank you very much for all of your hard work.
Thank you for your support. I appreciate it.
Yeah. Thank you, Jessica, for coming. It was great. Thank you to the students as well.
Yes. And to the families.
And the host families,
yes,
were wonderful.
Absolutely.
Having the kids. And thank you very much. So that did really work out well. Next up, we'll switch into Fine and Performing Arts. So Dr. Christy Whittlesey.
Hello. So thank you very much for having me in. This is Youth Art Month. It's also Music in Our Schools Month. So it's a very exciting month for us, filled with exhibits and festivals and competitions. So I'm very happy to be here to share with you today. So the Chelmsford Public Schools vision statement addresses our focus on not only providing students with multiple pathways to optimize their potential for academic excellence, leadership, and social-emotional wellness, but it also highlights that we're committed to facilitating an environment where every student feels safe and supported, and where student successes are celebrated within and across schools and in our community. So to that end, this short presentation will focus on our work this year in creating safe and responsive arts learning spaces. And I'm also excited to share lots of great news about what our students have accomplished. So our new arts framework released by the Department of Elementary and Secondary Ed has a three-pronged foundation of artistic intent, rigor, and cultural responsiveness. And these concepts are very deeply embedded in the framework. The DESE defines cultural responsiveness as an approach to viewing culture and identity as assets, including students' race, ethnicity, or linguistic assets, among other characteristics. And within this framework, cultural identity is valued and embraced within curriculum and instruction. Since the new framework was released, the arts faculty has been committed to examining what a culturally responsive arts program is here in Chelmsford and making adjustments to our classrooms to make them more inclusive and representative of the students that we have in front of us. So this slide presents a sample of professional development work we've done this year to continue this conversation. As a result of our work this year focused on culturally responsive arts classrooms, we've had many new lessons and resources created by the teachers, and we've been reviewing literature in our libraries, also our music libraries, to examine who is represented and what gaps there are. So through this process, we built new connections in the greater community when possible to support this work. For example, both of our middle school orchestras are currently collaborating with composers to develop new pieces. And Luke Miller, our McCarthy Orchestra teacher, describes the value of this process as follows. He says, "The process of commissioning a new piece has been exciting and enriching for me and the students. We have been working with Janelle Zook Kunalata, who has created a new piece of music specifically for us. The students had the opportunity to virtually meet with her in the spring, submitting ideas, requests, and suggestions for what they wanted to see in the music. Students contributed ideas and said things like, 'I think this piece should tell a story of who we are, something that people would hear it and picture us or think of us.' As we've been rehearsing and getting to know the music, the composer even invited the students to help come up with a title for the piece. The entire process has brought music to life for the students. Music is not just a series of dots and symbols on a page, but it can be a living piece of art. Music starts with an idea or inspiration, and a composer can make that idea come to life, allowing the music to tell its story." We also have a young composer of color working with the Parker Orchestra teacher, Lisa Tiano, and the Parker Orchestra students on a new piece called Voices of the Unheard that celebrates inclusivity and uplifting historically marginalized voices and artists. And so it's really exciting to see these pieces come together as the composers, students, and teachers collaborate. We have also forged new partnerships within the visual arts community to support culturally responsive learning spaces. And I am going to now introduce Amy Brown, our wonderful BIAM art teacher, to talk about that process. And before she does, I need to let everyone know that Amy has been designated the Massachusetts Art Educators Association Elementary Art Teacher of the Year, which is a huge accomplishment.
Thank you. We were very lucky at BIAM that we were able to have an artist in residence with Bren Bataclan. He spent last week at BIAM. It all came to play a couple years ago during COVID, when we were starting to explore new artists and try to make connections with our community and bring artists from all parts of the world into the classrooms virtually, and found out that Bren was actually Boston-based, even though he was born in the Philippines. And through the support of our BSA, which is the BIAM PTO, we were able to bring Bren to BIAM. And he spent a week with us where he talked to the students about using their art to spread kindness and smiles. What he does is he started off by painting small paintings and hiding them around the city of Boston with a note attached that said, "If you find this painting, it's yours to keep as long as you promise to smile at random people more often," which is just such an amazing message. So a couple of years ago, we did a small project at BIAM where students made little smiling characters and were told to hide them around Chelmsford. So if you ever find a little smiling drawing in the library or the grocery store, it could be a BIAM artwork from a couple years ago. But the students were very happy to have Bren visit the school, and he spent the week with them creating drawings and characters based on pride and the three R's at BIAM. And then he took all their little drawings and turned them into four canvases, which will be installed in the cafeteria. So they got the chance to see their artwork really come to life. Oh yeah, here they are. So Friday, just on last week, he did the unveiling with each class. The students were able to ask questions about the process, which they had kind of walked by in the hallways all week. So they were very excited to, you know, speak with him and talk about, and he also shared, you know, his life and his experience with just using art to spread smiles, and what an amazing chance that has been for him to meet students and people from all around the world, which is exactly what we're trying to do. We're trying to really bring people from all over the world into the classrooms and have people appreciate culture. Thank you.
Any questions for Amy before?
No, thank you.
Go ahead. Make a comment?
Sure.
I just want to say, in my parent group, you're really popular. You're super popular. Everybody loves you and the work you're doing. including Ian, my son. So so thank you for the work. That's all.
Thank
you.
I
want to interject that.
I feel very, very lucky to work in a community that is as supportive of the fine arts as Chelmsford is. So thank you.
And we're very lucky to have you working with our students.
Thank you.
Okay, so now is my favorite time when I can share news about some of the many student accomplishments in the art this year. Each year, the Chelmsford Public Library hosts our 8-12 Youth Art Month exhibit. And this exhibit runs throughout the month. If you haven't had a chance, I encourage you to visit the library to see the hundreds of amazing pieces on display. And these pictures are from the opening reception when over 400 students, family members, teachers, and administrators came together to support the student artwork. And the QR code is there in case anyone wants to see the students who have artwork displayed at the library. We also have 50 pieces of artwork currently displayed in the Massachusetts Art Educators Association virtual Art Month exhibit. And again, there's our QR code if you want to see the Chelmsford pieces. And you can also see the scope of the work that's on display, everything from weaving to painting to animation. And that is one benefit of a virtual art exhibit is that we can showcase our computer-generated artwork. In addition, two middle school artists have their work featured on the cover of the Massachusetts Music Educators Journal that is viewed by thousands of educators across the Commonwealth. So congratulations to these students and all of their teachers. We also have many successes to celebrate in the performing arts. Three students recently won METG, Mass Educational Theater Guild Awards, for our production of Lost in Gibtown, directed by Timmy Chase, and we're now gearing up for our annual children's play. We had two high school students who traveled to Seattle to learn from internationally renowned band conductors as part of the Western International Band Clinic, and special thanks to band teacher Matt Sexauer for facilitating these students' participation in that special event. And our Tri-M Music Honor Society is very active at CHS. And this year we welcomed another new round of inductees who will develop confidence, creativity, critical thinking, compassion, and a host of other leadership skills through performance and community service. Congratulations to all of our Tri-M Music Honor Society members and their advisor, Amanda Rader. There are a lot of names on this slide, but I did want to highlight the success of our 22 grade 4 to 6 musicians who have been accepted into the Massachusetts Music Ed Association's All-State Treble Choir, and our 7 CHS musicians selected for the MMEA All-State Music Festival. These students will have the opportunity to perform with other dedicated musicians from across the state as part of these festivals, and our high school students will be performing at Symphony Hall in Boston at an upcoming date. So bravo to these students and their teachers, Matthew Buono, Chris McGillicuddy, Jody Richardson, Martha Robertson, Matt Sexauer, and Kate Como. And last but not least, you may wonder why these beautiful people are behind me. Our a cappella programs, directed by Amanda Rader, this year. And both of our high school ensembles, the Thursdays and the Crescendos, here with me tonight, advanced to the International Championship of High School a cappella Northeast Region semifinals, which were held at Mechanics Hall this past weekend. The Crescendos placed second, and the Thursdays won third place, and both groups are currently applying for the wild card slot for the finals, which will be held in New York City. So cross your fingers for both of these groups. And also, if you just pop back to the previous slide for a second, the two people on the end there are Jackie Pottle and Josh Timmons, who are alumni, and they are at Northeastern now performing with the a cappella group, the Nor'easters. So the music continues after these students graduate from CHS. So at this point, thank you, Dr. Hirsch. It's my pleasure. You know, I always like to end the arts presentation with some live music. So please welcome the Crescendos, and one of our co-presidents is going to, oh, both of our co-presidents, come on, come right up, and we'll pull up another chair.
Hey everyone, we are the Chelmsford High School All Treble a cappella group, the Crescendos. We are so honored and thrilled to be performing for all of you this evening. We all have such an amazing year building so many new friendships and learning how to become better leaders and team players and finding what hard work and dedication looks and feels like. As a group, we compete in various competitions, including the one we just competed in this past weekend, ICHSA.
This group has made me truly find myself as not only a performer and singer, but also a person who has become educated in what a leader is, contributing to how I perform in not only a cappella, but school and classes as well. As students in high school, I can truly tell you that this club and activity has had the largest effect on me as a student, artist, and an individual. Now, enough of me. Here are the crescendos.
I would shun the light, share an evening's cool and quiet. Who would trade that hum of night for sunlight?
Amazing. Thank you so much.
Really amazing.
That's beautiful.
I've got goosebumps.
I'd like to introduce this for future meetings.
I cry every time they sing. So any questions before we wrap up?
That was my only question. Can you just do that at the beginning?
Every time?
Every meeting? Be better.
I'll stop for Jeff's last meeting.
Yeah.
Well, I can show up and sing if you want.
You can. You certainly get it.
Chrissy, I'm just curious. That was beautiful. They did a phenomenal job.
Yeah.
Is that a, I'm just curious, is that a piece from their performance?
Yeah, that's from their set that they took to the ICHSA.
That's amazing.
And, you know, but they have choreography and everything that
right.
they add, but they scaled it down.
Yeah. Well, that was beautiful. So both groups are performing in this next state round?
So they just performed over the weekend at Mechanics Hall.
Okay.
And only one ensemble moves on to New York
okay.
from every state. And so they're one of, I think, 13 groups applying through the wild card round to make it into New York City. So both of our a cappella ensembles are applying, and we'll see what happens.
That's amazing. They did a phenomenal job.
Well, thank you very much for being here tonight. I think it goes without saying that our arts program, our performing arts, visual arts, and all do a remarkable job. And, it, you know, I mean, I think about some of the performances that we've seen at the high school that, you know, I bring my mom too or something like that, and they're so impressed with the talent of our students, and you know, it really is amazing to see these kids accomplish as much as they do, and it always makes me feel good to hear people say that after they've seen a performance that's as good as anything that they might have seen on Broadway or something like that. So it's really amazing, and you've done a great job. Great job with the department.
Well, thank you. We have really dedicated kids and an amazing faculty. So we're very lucky.
Thank you.
Thank you. Amy, thank you, too. Okay. You are doing wonderful work over by. I appreciate it.
Do we need a
okay. What's that?
Do we need a minute to get
this? Yeah, I just need 1 second. Do you want to be a filler for me while I get this going?
All right, so, sure. Up next, we're waiting for Roger Hatch to come on. He's going to be joining us remotely to talk about the Chapter 70 state aid that we were notified through the governor's budget, of course. Only at this point, we found out the amount. Obviously, we wanted to understand a little bit more about where that came from. And, well, to be honest with you, if it was for real. But I'm hearing... and Joanne, I'm sure you've heard the same thing. I've been reading a lot of articles from cities and towns across the state who are also seeing quite a change in their Chapter 70 funding in for the positive. So, you know, I guess we weren't alone. So.
Yeah, I just need one moment to get...
Okay, I'll keep going then.
to get a filibuster.
Get Roger on.
Want to take like a five-minute recess?
Sure. Why don't we take a five-minute recess?
Okay.
All right.
Do you need 5 minutes? It involves technology, so I think 5 minutes is the minimum for you. So
that was really uncalled for.
6:55, right back here. That's 3 minutes.
Yeah, see, it says you're presenting now.
Okay.
But it's not saying what you're presenting.
Yeah, I'm opening up the PowerPoint. Oh, I see. Share. Send a link. Asking me to send a link.
Yeah, it shouldn't. It should just be giving you the.
Okay, so I'll try it again. It went away. Okay.
Do you want to try to shut off the screen sharing? And then I'll just see if I can pull up the presentation for you. At least we have you visible now. And you can just kind of give me the nod and I'll go through it for you. So at the bottom, there should be the little screen. You just need to click it to put the write off so you're not presenting anymore. Oh, you know what I can do? I can
Share. Should I turn click on that?
Yep. Yes, please. And stop sharing. Okay. Correct. Now, what's odd is you just went away from us, like visually, the picture. And we want to see him.
No.
It's actually a little more complex.
Now am I back on?
Nope, give me 1 second.
Screen.
It's odd. We can see your computer screen, but we can't see you. So I want you to, I'm going to basically take you off from doing the presentation and hope that you can just come on yourself with the camera. So let me just do this. It's funny now that I get. I tell you what, Roger, could you do me a favor? Could you just go out and then come back into the meeting? That might help just kind of refresh everything.
So he's sharing, but he's sharing the screen but doesn't have the PowerPoint.
I think I'm just going to do the PowerPoint for him. Nope, I don't. I still don't see your face for some reason.
Bye.
Can you hear me, though?
Mm-hmm. I can hear you. Would you like me to just, are people okay if I just project the presentation?
Sure.
And Roger can just talk it through? I think that'll work out, Roger. Just let me set the context for you. So this is obviously we're at the Chelmsford School Committee meeting. You can only see me, but we're in the school committee room with all of our school committee members, Joanna Johnson Collins, our business administrator, Linda Hirsch, our assistant superintendent. And we had a couple of presentations, which is why you're starting a few minutes late. But one of the things that the school committee was very interested in, and I was as well, is the recent governor's budget that had come out included a pretty significant increase in Chapter 78 for Chelmsford, and that hadn't been the trend. As you know, you've worked with us previously to do some analysis of Chapter 70 funding and net school spending in Chelmsford, and we were very happy to see this increase, and I guess twofold. I know you've kind of done a little more analysis, which you're going to walk through with us tonight. We're curious to know, you know, what is the likelihood that that number would prevail in the ultimate, the House and the Senate budget when that goes forward? And as interested as we are for fiscal 24, we're actually in pretty good shape financially. We just went through that budget. We'll be presenting at town meeting in April. I am not speaking for the committee, but I think I shared with the committee the kind of the longer-term projection of, is this some type of a revenue source, or is the formula now going to affect us every year? We can start to expect a little bit more than that minimum calculation. We were typically getting about $30 a head per student, just that minimum aid. But are we now moving into a different category where we may end up getting more significant funding in fiscal 25, 26, and beyond as the Student Opportunity Act is fully implemented? So I will turn it over to you. I have your presentation up just with your front slide, and you just give me the nod, or, well, don't give me the nod because I can't see you. Just say advance, and I'll move the slide forward for you.
Make the old noise like this.
Okay, well, let's go to the second slide. I can't see myself, but we can make this work.
Okay.
The Student Opportunity Act, you know, there was a foundation review commission in 2015, and that resulted in the SOA being passed in 2019, making numerous changes to not just education finance, but also accountability and governance. So fiscal 24 is going to be the third year of a six-year phase-in of the Chapter 70 rates. Look at this graph. We're going along at a moderate pace of $100 to $200 million increases statewide, most of the beginning of the last decade. And then all of a sudden, the SOA has its first year. And it's really not as much as people expected. It was a little bit more than $200 million. But remember what happened? That was the first year of COVID. And so enrollment dropped statewide by 3%, which is unprecedented. And it wasn't really until fiscal 23, and then what we see in fiscal 24, that the full power and promise of the SOA is being realized. By the way, it's nice to be here with you this evening, everybody, again. And so I'm happy to have the chance to talk about my favorite topic, Chapter 70. And things are looking very good on the Chapter 70 front right now.
Good.
So next slide.
And just so you know, Roger, we can hear you perfectly.
Yes.
It's just the visual. So you're coming in loud and clear, and we're equally as excited to hear about Chapter 70 and talk about that with you tonight as you are.
Okay, so this slide shows the Chapter 70 website. And if you go to this URL and then go down to the second section, Chapter 70, State Aid and Spending Requirement, then click on the first link there for the fiscal 24 preliminary numbers. Next slide. At the bottom of the cover memo, you select the complete formula spreadsheet. And what that allows you to do, we're not going to do it tonight, but I'm showing you how, is to download all the details about how the formula works. And I'd like this evening, if you'll bear with me, to spend a little bit of time showing you how the formula works, because you may have been surprised by the magnitude of your 18% increase. Last year, you got an increase of 600,000. This year, 2.1 million. So you probably were surprised, and there's a reason why that's happening. It's not a mistake. It's the formula doing its thing. So this evening, I'd kind of like to show you what this thing is that the formula does. Next slide, please. So there are six key factors in the formula. On the foundation budget side, inflation plays a big, big role. Enrollment, what formula wouldn't be reflective of what's happening on the enrollment in a district? And the wage adjustment factor, not to be taken lightly. For Chelmsford, you're at 100%. Nobody is allowed to fall below 100%. But this factor attempts to measure geographical differences among within the state and how much it costs to provide education. And Chelmsford is in the Billerica, Lowell, Chelmsford labor market area, one of 22 areas in the state. And it happens that the mix of the 14 towns that are in that particular area yield a factor that is slightly below 100%. Nobody's allowed to be below 100%, so you're set at exactly 100%. In other words, all the rates you see in the foundation budget spreadsheet are exactly what are used for Chelmsford. If you were Cambridge, you'd be getting a 12% increase in the salary-related items in the foundation budget. That's the highest in the state. Chelmsford has been as high as 10% back in fiscal 03, but in recent years, it's been at the 100% level. Required contribution relies upon property value, residential income, and the municipal revenue growth factor is what DOR calculates to try to estimate how much revenue is a town going to have available to share with schools. And so these six factors really are what drive the formula. If you think about it, all these are external. You have no control over how these factors work. And so if anyone seems to imply, if you're having a year when you didn't get as much aid as you thought you might get, or you only got the minimum, you were expecting more, don't let anyone imply to you that you did something wrong. There's very little that a district can do to influence any of these factors. It's all data, and it all comes to play at various points in the formula. It's not like a grant, in other words. A grant, someone could say, well, why did that town get a grant and we didn't? It probably depends partly on the quality of your application. Well, Chapter 70, there's no application. It's just it's money that's calculated by the state in its attempt to share in the cost of education. And there's very little input from the districts in terms of, besides reporting enrollment, in terms of how it all works. So you're doing nothing wrong if you have a year in which you don't get much. Next slide, please. So Chapter 70s, the formula is determined in three basic steps. I often like to think of this as an elevator conversation, pared down description about how the formula works, as if I were going up in an elevator and on the bottom floor, somebody had asked me, how's the darn formula work anyway? Well, this is my elevator version. By the time we get to the fourth floor, hopefully people understand the basics, which are calculate a foundation budget, which is an adequate spending level for each district. Determine how much a town can pay for that foundation budget. And of course, poorer communities are required to pay less, wealthier communities more. Then the remainder is funded by Chapter 70. And by now we're at the fourth floor. And hopefully you understand the basic core concepts of how the formula works. By the way, in my entire career, even though I worked in a building with an elevator, nobody ever did ask me that question. unfortunately, I was all prepared. Maybe someday. So the foundation next slide. I'm on the instructional category slide.
Yes, correct. With you.
Okay. 67% of the statewide foundation budget is comprised of instructional categories, mostly teachers, but also other teaching, instructional leadership, pupil services, guidance, psych, and professional development. Next slide, please. This SOA mandates rate increases in five areas. Low-income students, that's the biggest by far. The rates are the highest. The rate of increase in these rates is the highest for low-income. It's a lot. English learners, benefits, special education, guidance and psych services. Those are the five main changes to the formula that occur under SOA. Next slide, please. Sometimes it's easier to look at what's not in the foundation budget. The foundation budget comprises most of what a district does, but not everything. If you want to spend more than the foundation budget, which most districts do, that's not covered. That's an option. Spending from grants, transportation. I mean, how would you determine how much should be spent on transportation? So it never was included in the foundation budget. Capital equipment, this is intended to be operational expenditures. Food service, there's a separate stream of revenue for that. And bonded debt service, also a separate funding stream through MSBA. Next slide, please. See, there's a range of foundation budget per pupil when you put all the calculations together. Chelmsford is at 12,493. And a lot of these differences are due to low income. Low income, the range on the rates in low income goes from 4,116 for the wealthiest communities, but they do have low income kids. So each low income kid gives them an additional 4,116. And it ranges all the way up to 7,576 per pupil in the poorest communities. So that contributes to a big amount of variation among districts in their foundation budgets. The other enrollment categories and functional areas come into play a lot too, but low income is the most prominent. Next slide, please. We're on the foundation enrollment.
Correct. Page 11.
So foundation enrollment attempts to look at the kids that the district is financially responsible for. So anyone being tuitioned out, that includes charter, choiced out, and kids going out to non-resident VOC or special ed placements in other districts or at private schools or collaboratives, all those are counted because the district is paying for them. Kids coming in through school choice or tuition agreements, they do not count, except in the case of their low income rates, which are significant, as I just said. The logic there is the education's occurring at the district, at the receiving district. They incur the costs and any additional costs associated with low income students. And so it makes sense to send the money not to the sending district, but to the receiving district. You know, your school choice tuition doesn't change if you have a low-income kid. It does if it's a special ed pupil, but low income does not change the tuition calculation. So that's the logic there. And just to make it even more confusing, for charter schools, the sending district does get to count the low-income component because the low-income rate factors into how much you pay in tuition to charter schools. I won't dwell upon that little bit of arcana. Chelmsford's foundation enrollment's been very steady over the years. Next slide, please. So, I'm on the each functional and enrollment category. It has a per pupil rate that rises annually with inflation. So across the top, you see the 11 different functional categories that comprise the foundation budget. Along the left, down the page, you see the various enrollment categories. And you can see each one of those has a rate associated with them. Each category, each part of the matrix, each cell. And you know, those are put together to yield the total foundation budget for a district. These just didn't materialize out of thin air. You know, they're the residual, what's left over after some changes were made in fiscal 07 of initial assumptions about staffing and what is the cost of staffing in all these different categories. What's the pupil-teacher ratio, for example, in elementary as opposed to high school? All those came into play when it was first put in place back in fiscal 94. Next slide, please. Chelmsford Foundation budget. Across the top, you see the first five are exclusive enrollment categories. And that means you can only be in one. And then on the right, you see counts for kids in various incremental categories. Those get added on top of the rates you get for being in one of the exclusive categories on the left. There's special ed, both in district and out of district, and those are not actual counts. Those are assumed enrollment percentages, making assumptions about your kids being enrolled in special ed a quarter of the time. So they'd all be 0.25 FTEs. And then there's a very high rate associated with when you put all that together. And in the case of tuitioned out kids, there's an assumption that 1% of your student population will be tuitioned out in special ed. The English learners, it's actually broken down by three enrollment categories, grade level categories, I should say. Those are actual counts. Low income are actual counts. And Chelmsford's low income count has risen a lot the last couple of years. It was I thought I had that here, but it was in the 800 range. Now it's all the way up to 1100. It rose quite a bit this year. The other thing I noticed is that preschool has risen significantly from 126 to 201 between last year and this year. That gives you an extra bump up in your foundation budget. So you put it all together, and down below you can see it's an average of 12,493. On the left, you see there's the wage factor, 100%. And the low income percentage, it's 21.75% of your total enrollment. Statewide, 47% of students are in the low income category. It's been growing. There was a lot of concern when they changed the method of counting low-income kids to the administrative records method back in about 7 or 8 years ago. They used to rely upon the free lunch counts, but that became unworkable. And this new method at first led to a lot of criticism, but I think they've reached the point where it's working very well. ESE has worked with other state agencies to ensure that they get as accurate a count as possible of kids who are also listed in various other state aid programs, state programs that are serving low-income families. The other thing about that is ESE allows a kid who's reported in SIMS as low-income over four different periods over the course of a year. It's not just October 1st, as the rest of the foundation enrollment is. So the fiscal 24 foundation enrollment is October 1st, 2022, but not low income. It's October 1st, 2022, going back the last three SIMS periods prior to that. So if you matched to other state programs in any of those four periods, the kids count as low income. Next slide, please. We must talk about inflation. There's a 4.5% cap in the statute. So Governor Healey has done everything in accordance with law when she capped inflation at 4.5%. Look how high it is, 9.28%. You know, we know we're living in an era of very high inflation. Hopefully it's going to be going down. But at the point at which this is measured, which would be the third quarter of 2022 compared to the previous year's third quarter, it was 9.28%. And that by statute is the measure that is used to determine how much we inflate the foundation budget rates. I'll just say that the fact that it's been capped the last couple of years, last year was 5.86%, but 9.28. Do you know how much of an increase there would have been this year statewide? Instead of 586 million, which was staggering, it would have been 1 billion. That's how much of a role inflation plays in this formula. So what are we going to do about this? I know MASS is pushing for the legislature to uncap this year's inflation rate. Maybe not even all the way, but at least some of it. It's a concern. I can see both sides. Inhering the statute is fine, perfectly legal. But if we intend the foundation budget to really represent an adequate spending level, then why are we not reflecting that in the actual calculations that the formula uses? Now, it just happens that this is occurring in a year in which a lot of districts are, frankly, they have a lot of federal ESSER money to spend. So maybe this is not the year to uncap it. I'm trying to be reasonable in the way I look at this. I am really concerned that if we don't do it this year, if we don't uncap it, we're never going to get it back. There would be ways to get it back in the future, but the further away you get from a year, it's harder and harder to convince people, let's go back and make up the missing inflation from fiscal 23 and fiscal 24. Next slide, please. Okay, now on to target share. So we start with this concept that the state's going to pay 59% of the foundation budget. We determine the dollar amount that that represents. Half of the state requirement is derived from property value. Half is derived from the income, the total income of its residents. So we take 0.35% of a town's total property value and 1.53% of the total income. And statewide, that yields exactly half coming from property and half coming from income. Any given town share is not necessarily going to reflect that same mix. Actually, there can be quite a range on the Cape. You know, it's up in the 90% range for property and 10% for income. And there are, we see the flip situation in some of the wealthier suburbs where income plays a much bigger role than property because they don't have much industrial or commercial. That's why. So the sum of these two calculations is called the combined effort yield. The target share is what we call the combined effort yield as a percentage of foundation. And target share is capped at 82.5%. That was a compromise made between the House and the Senate when this method was first put in place back in fiscal 07. House wanted 15, Senate wanted 20, so they split the difference and made it, well, the House wanted 80, the Senate wanted 85, and so they split the difference to come up with 82.5. But 166 communities fall into this cap. And that's good for them. You know, they probably have much more ability to contribute to the foundation budget. But the state does have a role in sharing the cost of the foundation budget, even in the wealthiest communities. Exactly what that percentage should be, that's pure politics, how they come up with that. But it does really have a role in funding some of it. And this is the number that is used. That's the cap. Chelmsford is at the cap. Next slide, please. Once we determine the target, then the formula determines how it's going to be implemented, how close we can get to that target in the upcoming year's calculations. So this is where the municipal revenue growth factor kicks in. The average is 4.75%. I believe that Chancellor's down in the 4.3% range this year, right near the average. That reflects the ability under Prop 2.5 to raise revenues locally. And so we want to get districts closer to their targets, but it would be impossible really to set every district exactly at its target. You know, they have a structural situation where their entire tax and budget structure is built upon, you know, what they got last year. And it would be impossible to require all the districts to go all the way up to their target. Nobody is required to spend more than its target. They used to be, but now we've gotten to the point where that's no longer the case. On the other hand, if you're short by more than 7.5%, we add 2% to the growth factor. And if you're short by 2.5 to 7.5%, another 1% is added. So in total, 288 of the 351 cities and towns are falling short by more than 1 or 2%. And this is because when foundation inflation is high, when it's 4.5%, even though it's capped, I mean, that's almost the average of the growth factor. So how is the growth factor supposed to keep up with that when the SOA is raising rates in addition to that inflation? And sometimes districts are raising or going up in enrollment as well. So next slide, please. I'm on the Chelmsford effort goal and fiscal 24 required contribution.
Correct.
On the left, we see, yes.
No, I just said correct. That's the slide.
Are you on the?
Yes. Yep, I'm on page 17. You're good to go. Sorry.
And Chelmsford's effort goal, you see the EQV, equalized valuation, the income, it works out to a combined amount of $59 million. Its foundation budget is $68. Actually, if you do the math, that brings it up to 87%. But no one's allowed to be more than 82.5, so Chelmsford is brought down to that level, meaning, conversely, its aid share as a target, it should be getting 17.5% in aid, 17.5% of the foundation budget. Although that target aid share, I should point out, even though we use it a lot to analyze how close districts are, how they're doing on the formula. But it actually does not play any formulaic role in the formula at all. The target local share is what plays the role. So over on the right, we see how the required contribution is raised by, I'm sorry, it was 3.99% for Chelmsford this year. That yields what we call the preliminary contribution. And that is 77% of foundation. So it is short by, we see down below on the right, short by 5.4%. So it falls into that category where it gets an additional 1% added on. That's an increment of $505,000. And so we add that to the preliminary contribution to yield the new target contribution of 53,028,118, which I've circled. The reason I've circled it is at this point in the formula, if people aren't confused enough already, they often get more confused at the next step. Because once you've determined that contribution, you need to allocate it among the districts to which you belong. I mean, it makes perfect sense. This is a townwide calculation. Property value, they're both townwide calculations. But it's got to support, next slide, two different school districts. So in this state, towns belong to as many as four different districts. Chelmsford belongs to two. And so we just allocated proportional to the foundation budget of the kids at Chelmsford and Neshoba. And that's how that 53 million that I circled on the previous page and also here is allocated. Next slide, please. I won't spend too much time on this, but you're seeing there's a definite trend occurring. In one case, good, on the top, the bluish bars. No one's being required to contribute more than what their target says they should. They used to be, because there wasn't enough money for the state to fund what it would have yielded in new aid if we'd brought everyone down when the excess was as high as 600 million. On the other side, though, the bars at the bottom, that shows distance below target. And of course, these paired bars represent on the left what the initial calculation is, and then on the right, the lighter shaded brown bar, what happens after you add that the required contribution. And look what's happening during the SOA era, the last 3 years. That's not a good sign. What's happening is the inflation is just driving up the rates at such a high rate that the growth factors cannot keep pace. And at least nobody is being required to spend more than their target. Next slide, please. Now we're at the aid calculation. Let's go right to the circled segment there on the right. This is the key. If there's one thing in this presentation I'd like you to get in terms of how the formula works, what's the key thing to look at? It's this required net school spending percentage of foundation. That means when you're at 100%, the sum of your required contribution and your Chapter 70 aid equals your foundation budget. And so Chelmsford, for the first time in fiscal 23, became what we call a foundation aid district. It's a little bit confusing to use that term, but that's become common usage. It means you're getting foundation aid above the minimum aid per pupil. And why has that happened? I think it's a combination of both your enrollment increase and the SOA rate increases and inflation, driving up foundation faster than the district can keep pace through its growth factor. And so what's good in this presentation at the right is that you can compare to last year and just look at the change. That's usually how I show how the formula works for a foundation aid community or district. The foundation rose, well, the enrollment rose 61 kids, 1%. Foundation budget rose 7.5%, slightly below the state average. And so that yielded $4.4 million in an increased foundation budget. So how are you going to cover that increase so you can stay at foundation? The overriding rule on this formula is no one is allowed to fall below foundation budget. If the legislature or governor ever allowed that to happen, we'd find ourselves back in court within 24 hours of it being released, I guarantee. And, you know, it's a good thing. It's good policy-wise. We define what's an adequate spending level. Why would we let any district fall below? So with our foundation budget rate going up 4.4 million, the contribution, we saw how that was done. It's only going up by 2.295 million. So there's a shortfall of 2.1 million, and that's why Chelmsford gets its 2.1 million this year. It's if you had qualified for just minimum aid, it would have been 153,000. Once you're in this situation, it's really good for future. It bodes well for the future because it's very seldom that the contribution can keep pace with the foundation budget, especially the next 3 years with all those rate increases in the foundation budget because of SOA. So I think you're in a good position here looking ahead to the future. And in fact, the number of districts in this same situation has risen dramatically in the last couple of years. There now are 200 that get more than just minimum aid. That's the highest it's been in a long time. Now, see the note at the bottom, foundation aid supersedes target share. I said before, target share really doesn't play any explicit role in the formula. Well, your target share is 17.5%, but when you look at the new numbers, Chelmsford's at 22%. Chapter 70 is 22% of foundation. And that is a result of the fact that, as we saw on the contribution side, the district is about 5% below its required target for its contribution. And so aid kind of goes the other way. And so don't let this seem pejorative in any way. You haven't done anything wrong. No district that meets its net school spending has done anything wrong. We're in a group of many communities where they're getting more than what the formula says they should be getting. Next slide, please. This shows long-term trends and the components of the foundation budget. You can see that required net school spending has been hovering right around the foundation budget, which is the blue bar. And now it's right at it, which means you're a foundation aid district. You have been a couple times in the past, the distant past. And it shows required net school spending compared to actual net school spending. So Chelmsford, like a lot of communities, spends more than it's required to. Let's take a look at the next slide. Well, first of all, districts often receive more than target share. This is a handful of districts that we used last time I met with you. You can see the target share is often well below what districts are actually getting. What? So you're not alone. And next slide. This is a long-term trend. Since the aggregate wealth method that I've just told you about was put in place in fiscal 07, this is how much excess aid. I don't want excess to sound pejorative, but it is on top. It's more than what the formula says a district should be getting. It's risen now, as you can see, to 859 million. That's out of a total aid package of more than 6 billion. So this is about 13% of the entire picture. So when people ask me, is this formula fair? I would say for the most part, yes, but it's not perfect. We could make it pure by taking all the aid away. So in Chelmsford, it's $3 million to get down to 17.5%. But nobody wants to do that. Not me, not you, not the legislator, not your, not the governor. None of the organizations who follow this stuff want to do that. I don't think that ever is going to happen. But, you know, it means that the formula is not working surely as it would. And I'll just leave it at that. Next slide. So Chelmsford is in this group in the middle of the 115 out of the 319 operating districts that spend between 120 and 150% higher than their requirement. This is in fiscal 23. Chelmsford is around 35%. Next slide. So short term, are these numbers going to hold up? I would say yes. The governor hasn't put out some crazy new proposal giving you all this money. She has run the formula in accordance with statute. So you don't expect a legislature to monkey with any of those six factors that we talked about. If anything, options might be available to them, where they could consider a higher minimum aid per pupil. And certainly uncapping inflation would be an option. They've done it three times in the past when it exceeded 4.5%. So you could, ESE will issue the final numbers as soon as the governor and legislature approve either the state budget, or sometimes they do an earlier local aid resolution. Next slide. Long term, I know you want to know, can we count on this money, this kind of money, again next year? I think you're in good shape. I'm not going to guarantee you're going to get 18%. In fact, I don't recommend using percentages, because each year the base, as it gets bigger and bigger, and then it's harder to match that same percentage, even with the same dollar amount. So here's what I think. It's good to have a quantifiable goal. We're lucky. The formula is one of the few pieces of policy in the state that has a measurable target, and we know where it's trying to go. So we're halfway there. By fiscal 27, we should be all the way up on the rate increases. Another good thing, this formula is in statute. So it's not tempting to legislators in particular to monkey with it. Beyond fiscal 27, inflation and the other six key factors are still going to drive increases. So there's still going to be a formula, and it's still going to be providing increases each year, but you won't have that SOA rate impact that you are the next few years. Will there be a way to recapture missing inflation? That is a key question. Next slide, please. Finally, I just wanted to throw in my two cents on the value of projecting Chapter 70 beyond just 1 year. I've done it. I do it each year just to get an early sense about how the formula is going to work. I knew it was going to be a lot this year. I thought my projection was $458 million. Instead, it came out to 586. And the reason? Because low income went up so much, and it plays such a big role. So right there, I did everything humanly possible with the best information available, and I was way off. A lot of districts, though, are looking, now that they've got this big increase, or maybe the last couple of years they have, is it going to continue? So they have asked whether ESE could do projections. I think it's dangerous, but there are some good aspects to the possibility. The formulas are securely in place. It's more accurate to do a projection than just expect what we got last year, which is what most people end up doing. And long-range budgeting is sound practice. The negative aspects of doing a long-term projection are those six key factors all change annually, except income, which is done every 2 years. Long-term projections would be quickly out of date. Let's say we did a projection of fiscal 27. That means three separate years of projections, 25, 26, 27. But then the actual numbers for fiscal 25 would come in, and all of a sudden, those projections for 27 are going to be out of date because each year's formula is always built upon the previous year. So you'd end up with so many different versions of the projections that I think it would really be confusing. It could be done, though. Also, it's human nature to assign projections the trappings of fact. No matter how many caveats are issued, once people see numbers, it's human nature to expect them to actually happen. And the other thing is you can't just do a district in isolation. You have to do the projection for all the districts. Because of those EQV and income percentages, those are a function not just of what one district is seeing on those factors, but all the districts. What's important in the formula is how much a district changes relative to all the other districts. So you can't do it in isolation. And I'll leave it at that. And I think that's it.
Amazing.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, Roger, that's great. Thank you very much. Just see if we have any questions? Do you mind holding for one sec?
Certainly.
Does anybody have any questions? Dennis?
My head still hurts.
I know.
I actually almost followed. Absolutely not. I don't have any.
Well, it's real, which is great.
Right. Yeah, no, the takeaway is we very much appreciate you kind of doing that review for us. As I mentioned earlier, we were just kind of curious to figure out, do we really think the number is going to stand in fiscal 24? So that's helpful. And yes, I also agree with you. Long-term projections are very difficult to do, but at least based on the formula, it seems likely that there would be a more substantial increase in 25, 26, and beyond than we had typically gotten at just the $30 a head as a minimum aid district. So those couple of points are certainly helpful for our budgeting. So, Roger, I thank you very much for doing that review. The committee thanks you, and I will be talking to you soon.
Okay. It's nice to be with you tonight.
Have a good evening.
Thank you very much.
Well. Bye-bye. I'll be in touch.
Just waiting for you.
Did you want to talk any more about Chapter 7?
I certainly put it out there, see if anybody had any questions or, you know, if there's any takeaways. I took a couple things away in terms of some of the legislative talking points we want to talk about later on in the agenda. But beyond that, you know, no. I mean, those six factors are a little troubling. I don't know how much they'll change in Chelmsford, but. Yeah.
Well, that's what he's saying. Like, those are out of our control. You know, right. We can't really change those. And year to year, we're just going to have to kind of take a look at the numbers.
Right.
But again, I do think the big takeaway for me, at least, is we've moved out of that minimum aid district. So it looks like we're going to get a better formula than previously. It may need to take a couple of years to kind of figure out what happens on that front. But again, the six variables, inflation is huge in this whole formula. You know, there's definitely a lot at stake. But it does look like the number is going to hold for this year.
Go ahead, John.
Just a comment. I mean, that was a lot. But, like, to the average person, like, what is the difference in funding going to look like with this budget if it passes for us?
Well, the example was, like, we...
Well, no, just kidding. Like, give me one number in English for everybody because it was a lot there.
A normal year, we had been receiving $150,000 to $200,000.
Right.
This year, we received $2.1 million, if it comes through.
That's what I think people really need to understand. It's a big significant.
It's 10 times higher than we normally would receive.
It's like when you read it on the screen, it almost doesn't seem like a real number. But that's incredibly good news. And Donna said when she got elected, she was one of the things she was going to work on. Mm-hmm. So she's getting all the credit for this.
Sidewalks.
That's right.
I do have a question. Yeah. So in the we'll use some of our neighboring districts that went through a period of development. And so they got additional monies to compensate for, the extra staff and whatnot. Where is that factored into the formula, in this new formula? If you've got a town, say, that undergoes a substantial amount of development, how does that factor in anymore?
Well, you can get Roger back on.
No, that's all right.
That's in that growth. You have to do the whole download the column.
All right.
But it's that community growth factor.
Okay.
And again, I don't know all the different variables, but that's one of those six elements. It's baked into one of them.
Okay. And then one of the problems that we had with Chapter 70 in the past, if I'm not mistaken, is that they didn't really go back and recalculate. Remember? In other words, let's say a town went through a period of growth. They received extra monies. Then they didn't go back and recalculate what they actually might need at that time once that period of growth was
always the example, how they would always get the money because when it first came in, they were growing and
right.
We had already done growing.
And then it's got to keep the money. Right,
we never did. So that's, I think, what...
So are we looking at like a reset every year now?
That's what he said.
It's what it sounded like.
Yeah.
It's basically that 6-year rollout of that Student Opportunity Act.
Yeah.
Yes, I do think there's going to be a little bit of fluidity over the next couple of years, but I think it is going to benefit us more. But again, we do have the enrollment increase. We have our the low income number.
Right.
It has dramatically raised even over the last few years.
Right.
We're catching up to the point where we're not that minimum aid district anymore.
Right.
And now the state is going to kick in. They're going to give us more money. The city's or the town's contribution also goes up.
Right.
Spending wise as well.
And then, so the rollout is for 6 years.
Correct.
And I believe at the 10-year mark is when they reevaluate.
They do normally would put a whole new commission together.
Okay.
To take a look at it.
All right. So that's kind of what I was getting at. Because part of the problem that I guess I get concerned about is, I mean, it looks pretty transparent on the surface.
Right.
But, what's happening underneath? When we talk about these factors, I would hope it's a reset every year and it's recalculated, but I don't know.
Oh, the formula is recalculated every year with the numbers. It's just the numbers but they change statewide.
Okay. So that's what I was asking. Is there a reset every year?
Like October 1.
Right.
Is when we have to submit our October 1 number. So again, it doesn't vary greatly, but they do look at that particular number. They look at how many kids we actually are taking into the district.
Right.
How many kids we're sending out. That changes on an annual basis.
Right.
How many kids are going to our tech school? How many are going to Neshoba?
Right.
How many aren't? All of that does get factored in.
Yeah, no, I know. I guess I was going back to the example of Westford, where those things may have been looked at, but there was this underlying number that never got readjusted. So
yeah, I can't speak personally to that particular piece of the formula, but it has something to do with the community's growth and development and whatnot.
And we just went through a census, which I don't know if that that new number is also being used. Which is, I remember him talking about this the last time, and I think that might have an impact. The other thing is we have more development coming in, and that will also have low-income housing as part of that development, part of it.
Right.
So, and we are at our 10%, correct?
Yes.
And a lot of city and towns around us are not.
That's correct.
Okay. All right.
Oh, you're talking for the 40?
For low-income housing.
I honestly don't know a lot about that.
Yeah. All right.
Thank you for bringing them in.
Thank you.
Yeah. Good information to have. Should we move on?
Oh, yes, please.
Okay. Fourth item of the evening. This is a good one. So one of the things that we have before us tonight, as we were putting together the capital planning, and Jeff, again, knows because from the capital planning committee, one of the projects that we're bringing forward, actually was brought forward last year, was a total refurbishment of the tennis courts and basketball and street hockey area at Chelmsford High School. So obviously it was a little too quick. By the time you get town meeting money in April, we couldn't pull it off that quickly. So we ended up having to really put plans together. The project is going out to bid, and it's anticipated that this summer, at the tail end of the summer, going into the fall, that area will be demolished and then will be rebuilt into tennis courts, basketball, a similar footprint, and the street hockey. But one of the things that, as we, again, looking through the records, the high school had previously, at the school level, named the tennis courts after Al Thomas, who we had talked about previously, but the school committee hadn't taken any formal action to do so. So I know the committee is very fond and would like to properly have the vote be taken and the area named, and then at such a time in the future when we actually have the new courts built, we could have a formal dedication ceremony on site. But what I pulled for you tonight is just a copy of our policy on building naming and a recommendation for the committee to formally move forward and name the tennis courts at Chelmsford High School after Al Thomas. And Linda was nice enough to put together a little bio, and I'm not sure if you would like to review that, read that, just comment, but that action is before you tonight. I don't know how you'd like to proceed.
Okay. So we have a motion here. I'll take that, please.
I recommend that the school committee formally vote to name the tennis courts at Chelmsford High School the W. Allen Thomas Jr. Tennis Courts.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Second. Sorry, I guess I got excited.
Is there any discussion?
It's very well deserved.
Absolutely.
You know, we put in so much time for Chelmsford Schools as a teacher, principal, administrator, school committee member, Rotary member. You know, I think it's definitely something well deserved.
Agree. Completely agree.
You know how I feel about Al. I mean, I've forgiven him for getting me onto the school committee. It took me a while, but I've been fortunate to know Al since I student taught, and he's a dear friend. He was incredible as a teacher, department head. We were deans together, and I worked with him when he was principal. And he's just a really great person and great family, and I'm really proud to be able to make this motion.
I just wanted to say, and I think I was also fortunate enough to actually work with Al. I didn't meet him as a Chelmsford person. I met him, you know, kind of on the school committee when I started being active. But I think the thing, you meet certain people, and no matter who you talk to about Al Thomas, they have some kind of story about how Al Thomas changed your life in either like a big or a small way. And people see it and they recognize it. And I've been really looking forward to seconding that motion for quite some time. Al Thomas is really kind of a giant for me, and how I, he's kind of the guy who taught me how to conduct myself a little bit better. So I learned a lot from him, like everybody else.
I agree. I think Mr. Thomas is a great guy. He sets an example,
yeah,
in the way that he leads his life, and not only in his career, but also in his personal life. And it's aptly named after him. It will be a wonderful thing to do. And my connection with Mr. Thomas has simply been to observe him as the chair of this committee. Many meetings that I attended where he was on the committee, I was here a very few meetings with Mr. Thomas, but I truly have also seen his work through the community involvement that he's had in addition to the school committee, and especially with Ryle. I think he's been incredible. So absolutely, let's do it.
I agree with what everyone has said. So with that, I will take a vote. All those in favor?
Aye.
5-0.
Can I just make one comment on the way out? So you know, after you're off the board for like 3 or 4 years, we're going to put a sign under it. It's going to be the Jeff Doherty. It's going to be Allen versus Doherty. And we're going to be able to put scores on it.
Yeah, that's right after we get done with bingo at the senior center. Then we can play tennis.
You got it.
I will reach out to, I hadn't talked to him ahead of time, I'll reach out to Al and let him know. And then obviously this fall when the center opens, we'll plan a proper dedication.
Perfect.
So, good.
Good work.
All right. Couple of procedural matters. The next one, I know Dennis had actually worked on with Joanna revising the school committee warrant signing procedure. So we have those revisions that have been incorporated into the document, and that's before you this evening for approval.
This is, you know, talk about COVID. We started this process before COVID struck. Got a little ways into it, and then it just kind of got tabled. And so recently we kind of got back to it and put something together. And so this was a suggestion from Donna, actually probably 3 years ago, to add this to our school committee handbook so that when new members come in and we say, oh, you have to sign a warrant, they know what that is, because they know a lot of us have, came into this role and said, oh, you're trying to sign a warrant. You're like, what's a warrant? You know, and what do I do? So we tried to kind of put something together so some of this new to it could kind of look at it, and we can remind ourselves once in a while also what we need to do. So that's what's here in front of us is the kind of new, we didn't have a procedure, so the.
Well, I'm happy to see that I've done it right.
You did, you were perfect. I feel much better now. After you. I
feel much better.
All right. I'm sorry.
I think it's a great idea.
All right. I'll take a motion.
I move that the school committee vote to approve the warrant signing procedure as presented.
Second.
Is there any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. 5-0.
Good work.
Thank you. Dennis did some more work on the school committee handbook that we have. The draft is before you this evening. Again, just incorporated that new policy that you just, the new warrant signing procedure and a couple of other updates. I don't know if you'd like to touch on them. And then we'd move to approval for that and get that posted as well.
Yep. So we need to find a place to put this in the school committee handbook. So it'd be easiest to put it in the appendix. So we did that. We had renumbered a couple pages. The only substantial thing other than that, and just a reference to that, is I did add some language in terms of negotiations, especially with the superintendent. I got to find the page. I want to say it's page 10.
10.
And I tried to.
It is 10.
Yes. It is 10. I just highlighted in yellow and none of the red line stuff that I could ever follow. So it's just in terms of when we negotiate with the superintendent, just giving us the option of either doing a negotiating team like we do with some of the other negotiations, or to negotiate it as a committee. Because it really wasn't apparent what was the best way to do it. And there's pluses and minuses of both. But now the future school committee, when they have to negotiate with the superintendent, will have that as an option. So I don't know if that's worded correctly or
no.
Yeah, it's perfect.
Okay. Other than that, it was just some page number changes. You know, so we moved some things around as we added stuff in. So the other things were just, I think we ended up adding a page in, because of the warrant signing. So yeah. That was it.
All right. Thank you very much for your work on this. I will take a motion, please.
I move that the school committee vote to approve the school committee handbook as presented.
Second.
All right. Is there any further discussion? So thank you again for all of your work on this, Dennis. I think this will be really helpful, for people who are new to the school committee to understand a little bit more about what their roles and responsibilities are, to community people to understand, what's involved in being a member of the school committee, and, anybody that's thinking about running in the future, I guess if they're interested, this is a great place to look to see what's involved. So.
And I've actually had other school committees reach out and ask if they could use this.
Oh, really?
Yeah, as a sort of a starting off point for their own. So then,
great. All right. With that, I'll take a vote. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
5-0. All right. Okay. So the next one up is the talking points on certain legislative matters that we would like to discuss. So I had started writing some talking points and said to Dr. Hirsch, I certainly realized after a period of time that I was actually writing paragraph rants. it really centered around Chapter 70, obviously, continuing to work with our legislators around making sure that these things that we've discussed actually come to fruition, because this was only the governor's budget. So we still have the House and the Senate to get through. And, who knows? So if we can begin the process of maybe talking to our legislators around why it's really important that this happen, especially for Chelmsford, then, you know, that might be a good place to jump off in terms of our talking points for this year. Does anybody have any other suggestions?
A building.
Yes.
In terms of, you know, we're going to be applying to MSBA, and although it's a separate entity, I think that the legislators do have some, you know, influence in that, and just to ask them to be advocates for us as far as that's concerned, as we try to push the Parker as a as a building project. And then, you know, it's one of the things that came up tonight is raising the cap on the inflation
rate.
And that's, you know, something that we could, you know, maybe they could, even if they raise it 2%, you know, 3%, there's still that, you know, that much more in aid that we would get, so.
Or, and higher minimum aid per pupil.
Right. Okay. So, yeah, those two things. So those might be areas that wouldn't just help Chelmsford, but they help everybody out, so.
Mm-hmm. Right, and, you know, I think that, you know, I'm thinking about Chapter 70, and, you know, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong on this, but, you know, looking at the MSBA, right, we're looking at a possible new building project. Additional Chapter 78 is certainly going to help us, okay, offset some of the costs, I think, that, you know, that the town, you know, may incur as a result of taking on a project like that. So, you know, we've this was part of my rant, you know, that, well, I'll just read it to you, that we've been historically underfunded, okay, that Chelmsford as a community is valued a quality school system, and the result has been that the residents have had to bear the burden of supporting the school systems through their property taxes. That Chelmsford Public Schools has had a student-centered approach to learning, meaning the services we put in place to meet the needs of all students, special education, ELL, and then more recently adding the social workers and additional support staff to support the social emotional needs of our students. That all comes at a cost to us without any additional support from the state. And that we have aging buildings and a growing population of school-age kids, school-age families. We're overcrowded at the elementary level, and we need their support to be able to help us relieve some of the burden on our taxpayers. So we've acted ethically and responsibly in all aspects of our educational programming and school system management, and it's time that they recognize and do the right thing. So that was my rant. But kind of tying all those pieces together, right? That, you know, we were talking about also the MSBA piece, and that, you know, Chapter 70 is tied to that, especially for Chelmsford. If we would like to see a new building project go through, we have to take some of the burden off the taxpayer. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah, and I think it's important people understand that, you know, what the budget we get from the town, you know, the town has to make up whatever the state isn't giving us. So if the state's giving us $11 million, you know, the town has to make up. If the state gives us $14 million, that's less than the town.
Right.
And it can make it be spent on other things.
Right, on other things, right.
Yeah.
Do you have any other thoughts? Anybody have any other thoughts? Okay. I'm sorry, go ahead.
I'm just going to say, I think it's really important for us to point out to our legislators that there are four of them. And I always think that because there are, none of them really knows us well enough. And so it becomes really important for us to show them who we are as a town. And I think they have to talk to each other in order to come to some consensus. And that's, I think, would be really good if there was any way that we could bring all of them together to talk with us.
Right. And I agree with you. I think that that's the next step. I didn't want to, you know, Dennis had brought up at one of our previous meetings that we didn't want to wait too long to let this Chapter 70 thing go. We want to get right on this right now.
Yeah.
So, you know, if we could reach out to our state legislators, the ones you feel comfortable reaching out to, I think we had talked about various people reaching out to, you know, legislators that they may have had a good relationship with or felt comfortable talking to talk to them about these particular things. So it would be Chapter 70, uncapping the inflation rate, higher minimum aid per pupil, and the MSBA. And then we have the Day on the Hill coming. I don't know where that's going to be.
I don't know if it's going to be in person or...
No, I heard it's in person.
Yeah.
But I wonder if it's back at the...
I think it's still back at the...
Oh, really?
Across the street, yeah. I don't think it's in the State House.
I'll find out for you.
I don't think it's in the State House either. I think it's at the...
Well, it's across the street.
The Mason, right? The Mason Lodge.
We go to, I mean, at the hall across the street. We don't go to the State House itself like we had in the past.
Oh, the big Freemason building.
The Freemason.
That's a gorgeous building.
It is a gorgeous building.
If anybody has never been to the Freemason building in Boston, it's absolutely, it will blow your mind if you've never been in it.
It is.
Yeah.
You know, it just makes it hard for us to be able to have a one-to-one conversation.
So if you're,
I'm a Freemason. I know where all the secret rooms are.
I think it would be really good on a turn.
I'm not saying there are secret rooms, but there are definitely secret rooms.
I think when the event's always been good. When the event was held at the State House, the luxury was more state reps actually participated, and you could just get better access to them. Mm-hmm. I have found that like the number of state reps and state senators who will come over to the new day just isn't as great as when it was in the Hill.
If our people don't show up, I'll just go to the Hill and get them. It's fine. Don't worry about it.
Well, that's what you end up doing, but you walk across it. It's raining. Like the last time was raining, so you're like, do I really want to walk?
Well, then I'll pick them up angry if it's raining, but I'm going
to
go get them.
Well, I mean, another option is to see if we can schedule appointments for them on that day.
Yeah, I think that's
all right. Idea. So we have a couple options. Certainly the day on the Hill, I think, is an important event. We can invite them in to a meeting.
Yep.
We can certainly do that. And we can also schedule appointments on the day on the Hill to visit them in their offices. So, but I do think coming here would be a great idea. Is there a time that is best, do you think, to have that happen for us? June? April?
Is June too late? I mean, is
I think June might be a little too late because you're kind of like, we're wrapping up and we're just getting into summer.
Yes.
Maybe May.
Yeah.
Yes.
Because I think April, so we've town meeting. We've got to get through and everything. May, you know, might be a decent month. We could take a look at maybe one of those meetings in May. We also have our agenda kind of quiets down a little bit toward the end of the year. That might not be a bad time to do it.
I think it's a good idea to bring the four of them together.
So let's take a look at that.
I think it's a good idea. I think we should be proactive and just...
All right, so in the meantime, we're going to reach out individually. We're going to see about a day on the Hill, exactly what's going to happen there, and if they're not coming over, getting over there to the State House to see them, and then scheduling a time for them to come into a meeting here.
Okay.
All right?
Yep.
Okay. All right, thank you.
Super. Next up is item number... 8, and this we actually bumped up instead of waiting until April begin with the transitions and whatnot. But this is our annual vote on the school choice program. So you have a memo from me that just details the grade levels of the 35 students who are currently enrolled in the district under our school choice program. And I just make a note that I kind of move them forward. I promote them a year so that 9 of those 35 are actually graduating this year from high school, which will leave us 26 behind. We had previously always kind of tried to get to the 50 because you get about $5,000 per student. So that generated about $250,000 of income. And we had earmarked that for the 101 leases that we'd have to do for that. For whatever reason, we have had some kids enroll into school choice over the last number of years and then withdraw. And during the course of the year, we don't refill them. So our number has kind of gone down a little bit. It would be a significant increase to go much more than a dozen to 15 students. So I don't recommend going up to, say, like 25, which we could accommodate. I'm recommending we just take the 26 who are already here, obviously already enrolled, they stay. And I'm just recommending we add another 14. I just give you the grades that I recommend them coming in at. That would give us $200,000 in school choice money to use towards the technology leases, and it's very manageable as far as the number of students. And you'll notice the bulk of them are coming in as ninth grade students at the high school, is typically where we take them in.
Is the one at middle school like a sibling or?
Yeah, we had a couple of requests for like family related students.
I'll take a motion, please.
I move that the school committee vote to approve to accept 12 additional students at Chelmsford High School in grade 9, one additional student at Chelmsford High School in grade 10, and one additional student at Parker Middle School in grade 5 under the Commonwealth of Massachusetts School Choice Program, bringing the total school choice participation in the Chelmsford Public Schools to 40 enrolled students during the 2023-2024 school year.
Second.
All right, is there any further discussion? The only thing I'll add is I had a chance to talk to the mom of one of our school choice students at the end of last year. The child was graduating. And the mother was very, very grateful to us for the education that her child received. And she felt that it was setting her up well in life. She had been accepted to Northeastern and was looking forward to going there. And she felt that that her daughter was very well prepared, as I said, as a result of having attended our school system. So anything else? All right. I don't have to do a roll call, do I?
No.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
5-0.
Thank you. We'll get those advertised. We'll get the information posted up the web, and the application will be up there as well. We'll usually close it around April vacation, see how many takers we have. So we will get that advertised. Item number 9 this evening is the MSBA vote. So we have, I retooled our MSBA application for the Parker Middle School project. It's generally consistent with what we applied for last year. But as you recall, we were not invited into the eligibility phase this past December, and we're hoping to push that application forward this year. So this is the one that requires, Mr. Daugherty, this would be a great vote to read. We do actually have to take a vote on the specific language and then include this into the minutes. So this is the recommendation for the Parker Middle School SOI to be submitted. I have to get it in by April 12th. If you folks approve it tonight, I'll go to the select board next Monday, and then we'll be able to put it in on time.
All right. Take a motion.
All righty. Having convened in an open meeting on March 21st, 2023, prior to the SOI submission closing date, the school committee of the town of Chelmsford, in accordance with its charter, bylaws, and ordinances, has voted to authorize the superintendent to submit to the Massachusetts School Building Authority the Statement of Interest form dated March 21st, 2023, for the Parker Middle School located at 75 Graniteville Road, which describes and explains the following deficiencies and priority categories for which an application may be submitted to the Massachusetts School Building Authority in the future. Priority 2, elimination of existing severe overcrowding. Priority 4, prevention of severe overcrowding expected to result from increased enrollments. Priority 5, replacement, renovation, or modernization of school facility systems such as roofs, windows, boilers, heating and ventilation systems to increase energy conservation and decrease energy-related costs in the school facility. And priority 7, replacement of or addition to obsolete buildings in order to provide for a full range of programs consistent with state and approved local requirements, and hereby further specifically acknowledge that by submitting the Statement of Interest form, the Massachusetts School Building Authority in no way guarantees the acceptance of the approval of an application, the awarding of a grant, or any other funding commitment from the Massachusetts School Building Authority, or commits the town of Chelmsford to filing an application for funding with the Massachusetts School Building Authority.
Second.
Thank you.
Nailed it.
All right. Does anybody have any questions?
One more shot.
Is there any discussion? Not a roll call.
No, you can just do a regular vote.
All right, just making sure. Yep. I feel like some of these should be a roll call. All those in favor?
Aye.
5-0.
Great. Item 10 this evening, I'm going to ask Joanna to review with us the kind of the first pass at budget projection for fiscal 23. Just before you jump into it, just for context, tonight we'll review it, answer any questions you may have, and then we'll wait until an April meeting. This is typically some of the funds we use for one-time purchasing in the district. We're still kind of going through that, and we'll present a list to you in April. But we'll at least do the budget projection tonight. So okay. Thanks, Joanna.
Yep, thank you. So in our quarterly summaries, we've been just talking about the narrative of some things that are coming in favorable for the district. And this summary at this time of the year is just putting it all on one page with just kind of numbers only by the DESE function code. So right now, the projection is of our $67.5 million. You know, we know we're going to be under in some labor categories, and we know we're going to be under because we prepaid tuitions last year, you know, for this year's tuition, and we paid it last June. So we've known that the big prepaid number was $1.5 million, and then the other ones add up for a grand total of $3.177 million under. So as the superintendent said, we'll bring forth recommendations for one-time spending with those funds, or, you know, other, you know, building other reserves as well.
All right. Is there any questions? All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good news.
Good news. Yeah. Yeah, no, definitely more to come. We'll really get into that in April when we come back from after the election. Item number 11 this evening is an approval or seeking your approval for some rate increases for some non-affiliated staff in the district. We had an executive session, a couple to actually talk about it one last night, so this kind of summarizes our discussion. But we have certain groups of individuals in the district that are non-affiliated, which basically means they're not part of a bargaining group. But positionally, they would align with positions that are part of a bargaining group. And traditionally, after we settle contracts with all of our contract staff who fall under a collective bargaining agreement, we would typically then go and grant salary increases, or you'll see the word COLA, which is cost of living adjustment increases, comparable in line with what we had negotiated with the other unions. As we were building the budget for fiscal 24, I noticed a number of places where we had positions that were either at central office or in the schools that were non-affiliated clerks and secretaries and support positions that didn't receive the increase that we had provided the PSP group during negotiations this past fall. We had received, or we had recommended and ultimately voted, a 2.5% cost of living increase for these employees back to last July 1st, 2022 for the current fiscal year, and then normally we would do a 2.5% increase afterward. You have a list of individuals attached to your packet that kind of fall within this category, and the recommendation was to retroactively go back and grant this group the same COLA increase that we granted the PSP unit. So it was a 6% cost of living increase last July 1st, and then it would be a 3% instead of a 2.5% cost of living increase July 1, 2023 for fiscal 24. So we're seeking your approval to do that this evening. We would then obviously make any of the adjustments necessary for the fiscal 23 and 24 budget and bring any recommendations forward if they're necessary. I don't even necessarily know that they would be to go ahead and pay the retro the difference. It's not the full retro, it's only the difference between the 2.5 and the 6. And then obviously for budgeting purposes next year to adjust and budget for 3% instead of 2.5%. So you do have that list in front of you, and this is one of our discussions in executive session.
All right. So we had the presentation. Is there any further discussion? All right. I'll take the motion.
I recommend that the school committee vote to approve a 6% increase to the annual salary of hourly rate of pay as specified to the central administration's clerks, secretaries, and support positions effective July 1st, 2022 at the regular school committee meeting on March 21st, 2023.
Second.
All right. Is there any further discussion? Questions? Okay. Dennis?
Aye.
Jeff?
Aye.
John?
Aye.
Maria?
Aye.
Don? Aye. 5-0.
Email.
Great. Our next kind of three categories employees are our building principals, our assistant superintendent, and our central office administrators. These individuals also don't fall within collective bargaining agreements. At the school level, the principal position is exempt from bargaining so that they cannot be part of a collective bargaining agreement. And what we had done some years back is actually put together a salary schedule for the principals, and which included some steps and lanes for them based on degree and whatnot. And when we were doing this, I believe we actually began back in fiscal 1920 We had included a 2% cost of living increase in the first year of all those contracts, and then the steps work off that.
Oh, yeah.
We had granted a 2.5% increase to staff within this budget year. So the presentation before you maintains the step and salary schedule that we had, but it basically takes, instead of a 2% cost of living increase in each fiscal year, it's a 2.5. So it's adding a 0.5% increase, and that's consistent with what we negotiated with the teachers and administrators and all the other staff in the district. So I bring that forward as a recommendation this evening for you as well. And those salary schedules are in the appendix included.
I recommend the school committee vote to approve the Appendix A non-affiliated principal salary schedule covering FY24, FY27 as presented.
Second.
All right, is there any questions? Any further discussion? Okay, Dennis?
Aye.
Jeff?
Aye.
John?
Aye.
Maria?
Aye.
Aye, 5-0.
Thank you. Next, we have our assistant superintendent, who also falls under an individual employment agreement. We have a salary schedule that's presented for this individual as well. Again, this changes the 2% COLA on the first day, as far as salary is concerned, to a 2.5% increase in each year of the contract. So it adjusts for that, and also has step increases in each of the 2 years of the contract. So you have that salary schedule in front of you, and I'd recommend your approval for that.
I recommend the school committee vote to approve the Appendix B non-affiliated salary schedule for the Assistant Superintendent of Curriculum and Instruction covering FY24, FY26 as presented.
Second.
Are there any questions? Any further?
You gotta make eye contact when you vote on this one.
any further discussion? All right, Dennis.
Aye.
Jeff.
Aye.
John.
Aye. Gotcha.
Maria.
Aye.
Aye, 5-0.
I feel like you're gonna vote on somebody's salary. Make it as awkward as possible, honestly.
Oh, gee.
Thank you for your input, John.
Lastly, we have another handful of central office administrators that, again, do not fall within a collective bargaining agreement. They're not part of a bargaining group. We had, similar to the principals, created a salary schedule for these individuals in the past. And this is actually our director of business, our technology director, our special ed director, our HR director, and our facilities director. So the recommendation here is also to maintain the salary schedule that we have included previously. We're going to go out a couple more years, obviously, to change the cost of living increase from the 2% to the 2.5%. And then there is also a one-time adjustment going into between 23 and 24 in this group, because several of the positions have fallen below comparables in other areas. So that salary schedule is before you as well. And I recommend your approval of that.
I recommend that the school committee vote to approve the Appendix C non-affiliated central administration licensed and non-licensed staff salary schedule covering FY24 to FY26 as presented.
Second.
All right, are there any questions? Any further discussion?
Thanks, Dan.
All right, Dennis?
Aye.
Jeff?
Aye.
John?
Aye.
Maria?
Aye.
Aye, 5-0.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that. Next is just a quick update on the realignment work for next fall.
You would answer to why.
Oh, okay, good. So just want to give you a few updates on this particular planning that's taking place. Work is actually progressing very well. There are a lot of people spending a lot of time and effort to really make this as seamless as possible. I'm going to touch on five different areas tonight. And again, the work really continues and is all kind of coming to a head, as you'll see in this work. But I'm going to touch a little bit on our transition teams. Can you go back 1 second? And then some of the staff assignments in the new school. Our leadership, obviously, transportation has been an issue that's been consuming some time, and I know is one of those curious elements for parents and how that's all working out. And then also we're doing a lot of work with district management group on our strategic plan and our special education opportunities review. We're also working with them on looking at and refining the middle school schedule, so that work is in progress. Go ahead. So first of all, I'd like to thank the staff from both schools. We had assembled the transition team last fall. It was a group, we had a working group last spring when we were actually looking with parents. We'd had some staff meetings to talk about this possibility, and we got some staff input in doing that. What we ended up doing is reaching out to those individuals, but then obviously we made it a little bit broader so that we had grade level representation from each of the two middle schools, specialists, and admin. And this group has been meeting monthly to give input from the school level with regard to some staffing concerns that they would bring forward for us to address, just any type of transition concerns between the elementary schools coming up to now Parker for the fifth grade, the transition from our sixth grade students up to seventh grade at McCarthy for next year. We're getting into kind of the nitty-gritty now. People want to know about, like, physically the move, how it's going to work, how are we going to pack, when that's all happening, because the school year is winding down. And then we also have been having this group deal a lot with the student and teacher transitions themselves, and how are they going to acclimate to the new schools, to the new setup. So there's been a lot of work and discussion among that group with that. Different events and times that they'll actually try to get together this fall to maybe co-host some meetings and tours of the facilities. As we have the two middle school presentations, a lot of the students actually have some good input about how they would like to see the transaction happen over the course of this spring. So that group has been meeting monthly and again is doing a lot of good work. So I thank them for their work. Teaching assignments, our staff teaching wise have all received their assignments at this point. Again, it was one of the things that I think were making people a little apprehensive, just knowing about the move and whatnot. We had sent early this fall, I'm not sure if it was right before the Christmas holiday or right after, but a Google form where they actually told us kind of what their preference was. Would they like to stay in their particular school? Would they like to transfer to the new school? I have to say 99% of the teacher requests, even among the specialists, it all worked out very well that people most wanted to stay with their grade level. So we have a good core group of fifth and sixth grade teachers that wanted to stay fifth and sixth grade. So if they were at Parker, they wanted to stay. All the fifth and sixth grade teachers from McCarthy are going over to Parker. And then it was the reverse. So our seventh and eighth grade content teachers from Parker are basically going over to McCarthy. On the special ed front, we had to obviously work through. We have some general special education teachers. We also have some program teachers. We had to work through those different assignments, and all but with about one or two of the special educators, we were able to honor their wishes. We did have a couple situations where we just needed an extra teacher in one school over another school, and we took a look at like how long people had been in assignments and how long they'd worked at particular grade levels, and really tried to honor people's longevity and service to the district. It wasn't a strict seniority type situation, but we really did try to honor that when we could. So all of those staff, for the teaching staff, assignments have been communicated. We also wanted to get this done before we did our district-wide and our building transfer rounds, because in the event someone got assigned a position that they weren't happy with or they wanted to try for something else, we at least wanted them to be able to go out into the district and the building transfer rounds. So that was completed. The next phase of the work is with our support staff in the buildings, largely our paraprofessional staff, and we're actually looking at what's a little bit more difficult with this particular group is a lot of them obviously are serving specific students, and we have the transition issue where the students aren't physically in the schools yet. So our fourth grade kids are coming up from the elementary schools to the middle schools, so we're having to really look at what the service needs of the incoming fourth grade class are when we're figuring out at Parker which kids and staff need to be aligned. And then obviously we have a better handle on who is in the sixth grade right now, who's going on to seventh grade at McCarthy. But the para assignments are a little bit more onerous, quite honestly, than some of the teaching assignments were. But we're hoping to get communicated out by April vacation, at least a good tentative look on where these staff are. And when we ask the professional teaching staff which schools or which positions they would like, and gave us a preference, we asked for the support staff to do the same. So we have those preferences, and we're just kind of working through to see where we can do the matches. And if we can't, again, we don't do the para transfers in the district until later in the school year or even over the summer. So if someone ended up not being able to be accommodated, they could always look to go to a different school if there was an opening in a different position that they would prefer after this process concludes. So I think I'll have a good handle on this by April school vacation. Did you, you looked like you had a question? Okay. Kind of shifting into the school leadership of the two schools, just to give you an update on where we are with that. Right before February vacation, we had announced some leadership changes in the two different schools. Jeff Parks, who is Principal Parker, is going to be going over to McCarthy to be the Principal McCarthy, and we advertised for a new principal at Parker Middle School. We did a wide publication, as we normally do. We got a good number of applicants. We completed the screening a week before last. Our interviews actually start tomorrow, so we have several nights of interviews. Linda and Diane Carey from HR are going to co-chair the group. We have, I believe, nine individuals sitting on that group to kind of help us screen, do the interviews, ask the questions. We have, I think it's three parents, three teachers, and three administrators. So that'll be happening. And the goal is to go through the different interviews and then bring forward some finalist candidates to me by the end of March. And then I would likely spend the first two weeks in April do more in-depth interviews with those candidates, perhaps have them come to the district. We'll have to kind of see what we end up getting for those candidates. But normally in that last round, it's some central office staff. I may invite in others to sit with those interviews and just kind of get a sense for the candidates. But if all goes well, I would hope to have a principal named by April vacation. So we're on track for that. So that is working well. And again, tomorrow night, they're going to sit here in this room, actually, with those interviews.
Are the assistant principals staying in there?
The assistant principals are staying in their school. So Kerry is staying at McCarthy and Mark is staying at Parker. So we will have that continuity among the two schools.
On
the transportation front, so I do know a lot of parents have asked that. Joanna and Peter is running multiple scenarios for us. And sometimes I don't think, you know, this isn't just like a quick thing you can decide on because there are so many different moving parts. And this is taking a little bit longer because, again, there are those moving parts. What I think the likely outcome of this, not to, you know, kind of give you the punchline ahead of time, but I think the likely outcome is going to be that we're going to maintain the ridership consisting of fifth and eighth grade students like we have now on our buses, and we will likely need to do a staggered start and stop at the two schools. I don't anticipate anything significant, more than 10 or 15 minutes of a staggered time. But what I anticipate doing is town-wide runs that would be very similar to what we have now. The buses would need to, say, do a drop-off at McCarthy for the 7th and 8th grade and then drive over to Parker and drop off the 5th and 6th graders and then go about their business and go do the elementary runs. Could go the reverse. We're looking at, you know, a couple of different situations. At the end of the day, obviously they would do the high school runs because our buses are doing three different runs. And then they would need to go to one school first, load up. So let's say they went to McCarthy and loaded up the 7th and 8th grade kids. They would then progress when the bus was full over to Parker to pick up the 5th and 6th and then go do their loops around town. I don't think there's going to be enough time, and it puts a lot of extra strain on the number of buses we have if we ever would decide to run two separate town-wide loops so that we could have buses only do grades 5 and 6 and only do grades 7 and 8. Up near the center of town, areas could be workable, but when you start sending buses out near South Row or near Gorham Street, and you'd have to have two buses running the same neighborhoods, if you ever had a breakdown, if you ever had a late bus, it's just going to exacerbate the whole system and then throw off the next tier of runs. So like your elementary runs would be even further off. So I'm thinking this is what's going to happen. One of the things that I'm not overly concerned with the number of buses going to both schools in the morning, because it'll be have to be similar to the high school where they will do a drop and go. We won't just kind of have them staging. In the afternoon, it's going to be a little bit more complex because we are going to need to have the buses come and stage in one school and pick up before they go and pick up at the other school. So I'm kind of thinking at this point, and what we're going to do over April vacation is actually have a number of buses come and do some layouts in the parking lots with us. But I'm thinking that McCarthy may end up being the kind of the staging school because we can utilize the back parking lot, which isn't used. They just have more space than they physically do have a Parker. So the buses could come in. You know, technically we would have hopefully 29 buses available to us. But we're going to work with the safety officer from North Reading Transportation and actually a number of buses to see how we can configure them all to be able to come in. Basically, if, you know where they close the gate aside from the police department? Mm-hmm. But the buses would start there and kind of go out near the tennis courts and the field. We'd likely have to reroute the parent pickup drop-off to the front of the school. So the parents would use the front, the buses would use the back, they can't commingle. And then they can just, when they're full, go right out the gate to go over to Parker, do a pickup and keep going. I'm thinking that that's what's going to happen. I think the big punchline for parents at this point, and again, I'm in the high 90s% sure, it will be 5th through 8th like we currently have riding the buses together, which is a benefit is that parents are going to have one bus stop, right? If we ended up doing it the other way, you would technically have two different bus stops, two different bus times when you'd have to get your kids on or off the bus. At least it's now for continuity's sake and even like babysitting and things like that. I think it'll work out fairly well. And that's going to be the most efficient for us to be able to manage the runs. But again, I'm thinking the April vacation week is going to give us a better sense of things. We can't pull large numbers of buses in during the day when schools are in to do the staging. So we're going to have to kind of do that over April vacation. But ultimately make decisions around May 1st, which will be timely because that's usually the time when Joanne would put out the ridership information for next year. So it is all kind of coming together. There's just a lot of work that's happening behind the scenes. But I do know a lot of parents have asked about transportation. And the majority I've talked to like the idea of just having the one pickup and drop-off time for the kids because that's what they already know. There have been a handful of parents that says, well, I really wish this would have been a time to kind of separate the two. I just don't think logistically in the end it's going to be possible. Any questions on transportation? No. And again, I think all these communications are going to kind of come towards the April-May timeline, which I think will be good. Lastly, and this is also, we actually had a 3-hour meeting this afternoon on the scheduling. So district management group, who's been working with us on the strategic plan and the special education opportunities review, they also, it's very upsetting, Linda. They also have a scheduling team and they have their own scheduling software that really works through all the intricacies of elementary, middle, and secondary scheduling. So we've had the admin from both schools, and Linda and I have actually been participating in this whole scheduling seminar with DM Group. It was a number of different sessions, a number of breakaway sessions, taking a look at the existing schedule, existing number of classes, how they operate, what staff are required to run different scenarios, and we're just trying to make some, again, we have the luxury once this time this happens that the 5th and 6th grade can kind of be on their own schedule all within one building, and the 7th and 8th grade can be on their own schedule within one building. We don't have to operate multiple schedules, and we just want to make sure that we're doing it efficiently. We're creating the best instructional blocks that we possibly can, and again, this is just a good opportunity to do that. So we had, like I said, another very long session today. We've got a lot of work that's going to happen over the next 2 or 3 weeks. We have our last coaching call with DM Group right before April vacation. I see this, again, all kind of coming to a head over April vacation. And then when we come back from the break, being able to share with staff first some of the mock and draft schedules to get a little bit of input. And then I'll be able to really kind of inform parents and kids before the end of the school year of what things will look like. But this also has been a huge undertaking. But I think it's good time that's being spent. It's just one of those things that people don't see. The work that's taking place behind the scenes, it's been a lot of work, but I do think in the end it'll be helpful. So that's my little middle school update for tonight, just kind of keep you in the loop and let you know what's happening and kind of where we're at.
I see something online, you're going to do some sort of thing on Chelmsford table, telemedia, like an advertisement. You were in the background, but I did see.
That's quite
Yeah, some of the students from the high school wanted to actually put together like a little show that talked about like some of the transitions. So I had actually earlier this, I thought it was late fall, maybe it was early winter at this point. I went over and I answered a bunch of questions. And then they had met with the two principals and got some feedback as well. And I think have now put together a show. I would have preferred a little different picture in the the opening of it, but I believe it is tomorrow night, so we're going to take a look at it. I haven't seen it yet, but I think it just, you know, the questions that they asked me were very student-centered, which I thought was good. It talked about, like, the transitions and how important it is to really have the kids feeling just a good sense of school, being able to see if they can get into the buildings ahead of time. You know, we traditionally have, like, some tours over the summer, but we're going to have to kind of beef that up a little bit this year. But the questions I asked were very good. And they want to know about the program. They want to know about, like, you know, the after-school activities and how are they going to happen, are they going to occur, all of those different things. So they did a nice job. I will watch the show. And that just popped up in my Facebook feed yesterday, too. Yeah. I didn't know it was coming, but it is coming.
All right, thank you.
So, and more to come. And if you have individual questions that come up from time to time, just keep pushing people my way. I'm more than happy to help them. And then, really, when we come back from April vacation, if I'm a parent, I'm going to start to see regular communications about what's happening. Good. And thank you to the parents who, you know, volunteered, obviously, to help out with the interview committee. We had more people actually express interest than we could accommodate. We had set up just a Google form to collect information about what people would like to see at the school and characteristics of the individual. So those have been very well received. All right. Item 13 for me is just the personnel report. And this is just your memo that kind of outlines some of the personnel transactions for the month of February, a few new hires, a few resignations, and we had a retirement. No action necessary on your part. I just fill you in on the comings and goings of staff. No questions? Okay. And then last for me this evening is just an approval of one field trip. This is the METG students, the Theater Guild at the high school, sending a group of students who are interested to go and watch the state finals in Boston. It's an overnight trip to Boston. Tim Chase and Lauren Cochran are going to bring a group. So I recommend your approval of that.
I move that the school committee approve the Chelmsford High School METG Students Theater Guild field trip to Boston, Massachusetts on March 30th to April 1st, 2023.
Second.
Are there any questions? Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
5-0. Thank you.
That's all I have.
All right. Does anybody have any liaison reports?
I just really want to say the Boosters Club Shamrocking fundraiser. Week ago Friday, Saturday, it was a great time. It was a good crowd. And
how do you get these liaison assignments?
You know, I don't know.
I don't get to go to Shamrock things. Hey, go ahead. Just go.
He's leaving. If
I'm
you
leaving,
like
so that's a bit.
Yeah, maybe next year.
Just volunteers and opening.
You're in. So, you know, and again, to the four liaison groups I've worked with, I've really enjoyed it. And it's been fun. And they do great work. I mean, they really do. The parents and the volunteers, they do incredible work. And sometimes it's not recognized, but they're really supportive of the schools. Like, our chippers do such a good job.
All right, anybody else?
I didn't have any meetings.
I went to, had an opportunity to go to the Science Fair at Center School. Superintendent, assistant superintendent also went.
Oh.
Mr. Doherty, I was going to get to you.
Yeah, Mr. Science was there.
Right, and it was great. You know, like, they hadn't been able to do it because of COVID. They actually were mentioning that the one they had was just as we closed down, like the day of, when they were able to have it. But it was great. The kids did a fantastic job. You know, well attended by parents and community members, and it was just great to see it back in action again. And then the Center School's PTO is meeting tomorrow.
Okay. You know, I didn't do PTO meets, but I went to do community reading, and it was wonderful. I was in Mrs. Knight's third grade at Center School, and everybody came in to the class. What a wonderful 21 children in that class. I loved absolutely doing it, and recommend it to everybody in the community. If you have a chance to do community reading, do it.
Thank you. The Chelmsford Friends of Music will be meeting this Thursday. Is there any other liaison assignment reports? All right, are there any new items or requests for upcoming agendas?
We had, you know, come through our email from our attorneys and from the, I mean, just on public input, that there's a new finding from I don't know if that's something we should have our attorney just look at our policy and make sure there's no language in it that goes against that finding.
It's a good idea.
Just to be.
Would you like me just to email him? Well, he sent out the advisory.
He said, that's why I said, he sent it to us.
I'll email my current policy.
Right, and just have him take a look at the language, make sure we're not in violation of.
Yeah.
We're not supposed to.
I spoke with Mr. Cohen about that. It doesn't appear that we are. It was an interesting finding. We'll see how things go forward.
Okay.
So, all right, do we have any public comments for the second public input session?
We don't.
Anybody have any emails? All right, then with that, I will take a motion to adjourn.
For my final time, again, thank you all. I couldn't have had a better 3 years and work with such close friends. So for my final time, I move that we adjourn.
I second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
5-0.